Ladies and gentlemen, today is March 18th, 2017, and on behalf of the Director of the United States Army Heritage and Education Center, Colonel Peter Crane, and the entire staff of the USAHEC and the U.S. Army War College, welcome to the 49th Annual Perspectives in Military History Lecture Series. The USAHEC and the U.S. Army War College sponsor the Perspectives Series to provide a historical dimension to the exercise of generalship, strategic leadership, and the warfighting institutions of land power. In addition, as always, we would like to extend a warm thank you to the Army Heritage Center Foundation for their support in everything we do here at the AHEC, and of course, especially their support today. Be aware that the speaker's book for today is on sale in the gift shop, and we will have a book signing after the lecture down by the bookshop. So today, it's my great honor to introduce our speaker, Dr. Conrad Crane. Dr. Conrad C. Crane is currently the Chief of Historical Services here at the United States Army Heritage and Education Center. Prior to this post, he served as the Director of the U.S. Army Military History Institute, and before that, he was an instructor at the Strategic Studies Institute at the Army War College, where he held the General Douglas MacArthur Chair of Research and the General Hoyt S. Vandenberg Chair of Aerospace Studies. He joined SSI after his retirement from a 26-year military career that concluded with 9 years as a professor of history at the U.S. Army Military Academy. He holds a Bachelor of Science from the United States Military Academy, United States Army Military Academy, and the Master of Arts and PhD from Stanford University. He also has a graduate degree from the U.S. Army Command and General Staff College and the U.S. Army War College. Dr. Crane has authored or edited books and monographs on the Civil War, World War I, World War II, Korea, and Vietnam, and has written or lectured widely on air power and land power issues. Before leaving SSI, he co-authored a pre-war study on reconstructing Iraq that influenced Army planners and has attracted much attention from the media and the Army leadership. He was the lead author for the groundbreaking Army and United States Marine Corps Counterinsurgency Manual, which was released in December of 2006. For that effort, he was named one of Newsweek's People to Watch in 2007, and he visited Iraq in November of 2007 at General Petraeus' request to evaluate the new doctrine in action. In November 2008, he was named the International Archivist of the Year by the Scone Foundation, and in 2016, he was selected to receive the Society for Military History's Samuel Elliott Morrison Prize for lifetime contributions to the field of military history. Today, he will be speaking about his most recent book, Cassandra in Oz, about the creation and application of the American counterinsurgency doctrine in 2001. Ladies and gentlemen, please help me welcome Dr. Conrad Crane.
Thank you. Yeah, thank you very much. My year that I'm supposed to be watched is over.
That was back in 2007. The irony there is
Newsweek came out to take a picture for the spread, and they ran me all over the trail. They jammed me in the Sherman tank out there. They jammed me in rooms around here. Finally, they decided they'd take a picture of me out there on the readout number 10 that we've got out there. And I said, hey, it's a great thing. You can put me out here and talk about how I helped influence our own counterinsurgency efforts here on the symbol of our own insurgency. The head out there was a cold, windy day. I'm out there in my trench coat as the wind howled around this really dark sky. It would have been a really neat picture with a caption. But when they put it in the Newsweek issue, there was no caption. Just me on this windswept parapet. And I got this note from John Nagel from the field. He said, Con, just saw your picture in Newsweek. You look like a flasher. So much for my year to be watched. I want to talk today about this is going to be a great day. General Petraeus is here, flew in special from Europe for this. We just drove him up from Dulles Airport. I want to talk about some of the intellectual roots, what we did in Iraq, and then we'll get a chance with him and the other panelists we have here to talk about the actual course of events in that particular war. As you can see from this image right here, that actually is a sign that's outside the embassy in Baghdad, which leads one to wonder what's really going on inside the embassy in Baghdad. I tried to get that actually put on the back of the book, but they said they couldn't, they didn't want to do that. The term, the name Cassandra and Oz, if anybody's familiar with Greek mythology, Cassandra was a woman who was fated, cursed by the gods to have to tell truth to power and never be heard. And I actually was christened that name by an NPR reporter who was doing a story on some of the work that I'd done prior to the counterinsurgency manual. Back in 2002, I had written a monograph for the Army War College that talked about the fact that the Army had run away from counterinsurgency after Vietnam and it was time to face it again. And then in January of 2003, I was in charge of an Army War College team that came up with a plan to reconstruct Iraq, and one of our warnings was it's going to be much harder to win the peace than win the war. And unfortunately, the day we finished that study was the day that Secretary Rumsfeld declared that the Army would not be responsible for post-war Iraq, it would be ORHA and retired General Jay Garner. So our study kind of sat on the shelf with the Army staff instead of going any further, though we did send it to CENTCOM and they did use it in some of their plans, which also were not supported. So I had this reputation as basically creating a lot of interesting but rather useless stuff. But I had a classmate of mine named Dave Petraeus, who had just taken over at the Combined Arms Center at Fort Leavenworth and was trying to change the way the Army was approaching current warfare. And actually, it's interesting because what the Army and Marine Corps do is they take a couple of their best generals from Iraq. The Army takes Dave Petraeus, the Marine Corps team takes Jim Mattis, and they put them in charge of the education and training for their institutions. And they start to come up with this plan of how they're going to get the Army and Marine Corps that's better able to deal with the problems of modern warfare. This is actually what General Petraeus called his engine of change, which is a knowledge management system, which involves getting teams out to the field to find out what's going on, bringing the lessons back into the system, both for doctrine, leader development, collective training, trying to get lessons back very quickly. I used to tell people that I was one tooth on one cog in Dave Petraeus' engine of change, because I was involved in the doctrine side, and was basically recruited. If there's any War College students here, be careful who you're sitting next to in class. General Petraeus and I, Dave and I sat next to each other in military history class when we were firsties. You never know what the guy next to you is going to force you to do someday down your career. But because he was aware of the work I'd done, other people were as well, he decided it was time to come up with a new doctrine to support this new way of warfare. And so he decided to start with counterinsurgency doctrine, asked me to be in charge of the team. And that launched this process that eventually would develop this new counterinsurgency manual, FM324, by late 2006. It was really an interesting, I can see some people out here who have been involved in doctrine writing in the Army before, which is usually a very long and tedious process. This was really unusual for the military. It was, the whole process took less than a year. It was a broad array of contributors. It was not just soldiers in uniform and Marines in uniform, it was also academics. We had a civilian anthropologist do a lot of our intelligence stuff. We had psychologists involved with some of our social network analysis. We had the leading lights of many universities come in to help us as well, people from the media, a very broad range of contributors. The main conference when we tried to vet the initial draft of the doctrine was co-sponsored by Sarah Sewell, who was the director of the Carr Center for Human Rights at Harvard University. It's a very diverse group contributing to this doctrine. It was a true integration of Army and Marines. Each chapter had an Army and Marine author, along with his civilian counterparts. General Petraeus was kind of the editor-in-chief. He read everything we wrote. I still have PTSD over a thing I call Petraeus pronouns. For any students out there writing your SRPs, if you use the terms this is or it is, be really careful what the antecedent of this or it is, because it'll come back to haunt you someday. Like I said, I still have nightmares sometimes about some of that. Now, the intent of the new doctrine was going to be applied anywhere, not just in Iraq and Afghanistan, beyond those. But because of the nature of the process, the review process, when we wrote the doctrine and went out to the, like I said, we had 600,000 editors for this doctrine because it went out to the whole Army and the whole Marine Corps to comment on. And most of their comments that came back were phrased very much based on their own combat experience. So the document is very much influenced by the combat experience going on at the time, especially Iraq. So it's, you know, you really look at this manual, you got to understand it's a product of the time period, and it's very much focused on Iraq, and that was where it mainly was applied. Let's talk about some of the details of it. Most of you are here probably aware of it, but I'll summarize them. What was different about this new doctrine was it wasn't just focused on killing bad guys. The first step was protecting the population. It's been called population-centric. That's a little bit of distortion because you still have to kill bad guys too. But the main thing you're trying to do is achieve, you want the people to accept the governing authority as legitimate. So, you know, it's very much a political struggle as well as a military struggle. And you're still killing enemies in some cases and capturing enemies, but you got to be very careful how you apply force. You don't want to kill 5 insurgents and create 50 more with the backlash. You've got to be very careful how force gets, and it's a mosaic war that differs from village to village and town to town and valley to valley. It's very hard to characterize this kind of warfare with any kind of a uniform description. Also, military force cannot achieve success by itself. Dr. Richard Lacquement was then a colonel who's going to be one of the panelists up here. He had to write the chapter 2 of the doctrine, which dealt with how to draw in all these other players into this kind of conflict, all these civilian agencies that are also playing with you in this mosaic war. Intelligence gathering is more cultural anthropology. It's a very different style of intelligence. You got to understand the gender roles, how the economy works, how politics work. And you've got to do something called campaign design, which I'll describe in a minute. The bottom line is you can't just start planning. You've got to figure out what your problem set is first. You're not dealing with one enemy. You're dealing with multiple enemies, each which take different approaches. Perceptions are reality. Managing information is key. It's more important what people think you have done than what you have actually done, because that's what affects their behavior and their attitudes. The main theme is really learn and adapt. You know, in many ways, we try to follow Michael Howard's dictum that the main purpose of doctrine is not to be so far wrong that you can't fix it when you get into combat. Actually, we had an exchange, I remember, with General Schumacher, the Chief of Staff of the Army, who talked about get this thing out and you want to make sure it's at least 80% right. So anytime people say this, point out something that was wrong in the manual, I say, well, that was part of the 20% we were allowed to have wrong. We focused on clear, hold, and build as a dominant approach. You clear an area, you set up security forces to hold it, and then you build the institutions. It's a very set-piece process, which involves a whole lot of players, also very expensive, very time-consuming. Bottom line, and we also talked about something called lines of effort I'll describe in a second here, but most of what we call counterinsurgency is really just modern warfare. So, I mean, that's one of the things, when you really come to the fore of this, this is really modern warfare amongst the people, and I would love to go back to a simpler world where it's just tank on tank and soldier on soldier. Warfare, I don't see warfare being that simple ever again. Now, this is modern warfare in a diagram. Basically, you've got the population, attitudes and behaviors of the people. You're trying to change them to support the government. And you have these lines of effort, which are just basically themed actions along certain categories. Combat operations are just one of many. You've got building host nation security forces, restoring essential services, developing better governance, economic development, and all wrapped in information operations. The people have got to know what you're doing for them. You know, it doesn't do any good to do a great action and no one knows you've done it. You've got to work with the information aspect of what you've done. The enemy does. Our enemies are very skilled at trying to distort the image of what we've done, and that's part of what you have to deal with as well. But that is modern warfare in a diagram. Very complex. This is not your grandfather's war. This is an example of, this is General Mattis's campaign plan in Anbar province. Again, we talked about this campaign design. You got to figure out what is your problem set. Well, General Mattis realized he had 3 separate enemies. He had a tribal insurgency, he had a former Ba'athist insurgency, and then he had Al-Qaeda, the foreign fighters. And he realized that each one took a different approach. The Al-Qaeda you had to kill. The Ba'athists, you want to try to draw them back into the political system. The tribes, they're just looking for some kind of security, economic development. Jobs are going to be the key for the tribes. Eventually, we end up hiring a lot of the tribal the tribes to be militias or to be security forces, and among other things. But the end result of the campaign is going to be we get these guys to kill those guys. You turn those set of enemies to kill that set of enemies. And inside each of these three different sets of enemies, you also have criminals that have to be dealt with differently as well. It's a very, very complex kind of warfare. And a number of you in here have had to fight it and to execute it. Now, it wasn't easy to get this doctrine through, and not just, you know, and sometimes it was hard to get it through our own bureaucracy than get it through the Iraqis or the Afghans. For instance, the initial numbering of the manual was 3.07.22, which meant it was the 22nd category under stability operations, which was 3.07. Those of us on the writing team felt that this was a different problem set than stability operations because the level of violence needed a separate number. When I went to the Combined Arms Doctorate Directorate at Leavenworth and said, I need to change the number of the manual, it was like a monk had walked into the Vatican and told the Pope, I want to rearrange the Old Testament. I mean, there was mass panic. If you change this number, the whole doctrinal hierarchy of the Army will fall apart. 2 weeks later, General Petraeus made the same suggestion. And obviously, they've been thinking about it a lot in those 2 weeks, because their answer to him was very different than the answer they gave to me. So it ended up as 3-24. Reference bibliography. We wanted to put a list of suggested readings in the back of the manual, and we were told that you couldn't do that because that would imply official endorsement of privately published works. Again, that's another question. When General Petraeus asked it, he got a different answer. But this remains the only Army field manual that actually has a list of suggested readings in the back that are actually, you know, well-known privately published works. Most Army field manuals are at eighth grade reading level. That's not because soldiers are stupid. That's because the idea is they're going to be read quickly and absorbed quickly by the common soldier. We said our target for this manual is mostly battalion staffs and above. This is a campaign level kind of manual. And so we got permission to go up to the 10th to the 12th grade level. So it's written at a little higher level than a lot of the other manuals are. We had big issues over detainee operations because of what had gone on at Abu Ghraib, heavily influenced by the human rights community and some of the things, the McCain-Feingold things that were going on in Congress. Had a big battle of the Air Force about air power. Initially, they didn't care. Then at the last minute, they started to care too much. And we had a big battle because basically what they did is the Air Force decided they would write their own air power annex, and it was basically designed to piss off the Marines. And so the Army ended up refereeing between the Air Force and the Marines to produce the air power appendix, which probably in the long run wasn't necessary, but it did help get the Air Force interested in counterinsurgency. We had a big battle at Fort Huachuca about the social cultural intelligence. It was not something they were willing to absorb. Had a big conference with them. Eventually they did accept it, and have actually become very big supporters of it. We had a big battle with Ralph Peters in the press, where he basically said there's not enough killing in this manual. Invited him out to Fort Leavenworth, had a big debate with John Nagel. We changed seven sentences in the manual to add a little bit more about killing, and when the manual came out, he called this the most improved government publication of the last decade. Now, he hates it again because he put out a new book, and he needs to rile people up again, but at the time the manual came out, he did like it. And in the paradoxes section, which also was kind of controversial, which was my contribution, I wanted to put something in the manual to make people think about what's different about this kind of warfare. So I came up with these paradoxes. You know, sometimes the more you protect your force, the less secure you may be. You got to get out and patrol among the people. You can't stay locked behind your forward in your forward operating base. You know, one of the great terms that came out of Iraq, out of the, you know, J.R.R. Tolkien meets modern warfare, you don't want to be a fobbit. You know, you want to be somebody who sits inside the FOB, the forward operating base. You know, they go through there. You know, sometimes the more force is used, the less effective it is. Sometimes doing nothing is the best reaction. If a tactic works this week, it might not work next week. If it works in this province, it might not work in the next. Why? Why does that paradox work? What is your enemy doing? Those bastards are learning and adapting too. So you've got to stay a step ahead of your enemy. That's one of the other paradoxes. The last one, initially when I wrote this one, I said, most important decisions are not made by generals. Guess who the last people are to review a doctrinal manual? The generals are. So they changed that one to many. In reality, that one probably should have said that most important decisions are made by voters and politicians, which I'll talk to in a minute. At least I kept them, at least it survived in the manual. A lot of people criticized the doctrine. The number of people said it was wrongheaded, like Bing West and Edward Luttwak. They said that the way you're successful in these kind of wars, you got to make, as you're a counterinsurgent, you got to make the people fear you more than they fear the insurgents. You know, in the CNN era, we're not going to fight that kind of war. We're not going to do that. Again, Ralph Peters said you got to keep the way you win these wars by killing the enemy. Don't disagree. You got to do some of that, but there's more involved than just that. We had a number of people that say this is basically just another tool of American imperialism. That one kind of surprised. I got ambushed at a conference in NYU on that one. Wasn't ready for it. Some people say civil wars are not coined. In reality, there's a lot of similarity between the both, a lot of overlap, a lot of they're all internal wars that have to be dealt with very similarly. You know, some people said that the old counterinsurgency thinking is no longer relevant. Mao is dead. Everything is brand new. As with everything, it's a combination of the old and the new. Even Al-Qaeda uses Maoist terminology in their own doctrine. So the old stuff is still relevant. Understanding, you know, a lot of things are different. The toughest arguments to deal with are these. Jeffrey Recker at the Air War College makes the argument that Americans can't fight counterinsurgency because these kind of wars take too long. The military doesn't really care, isn't invested in anything other than the conventional warfare. And our political system and society really can't last more than four-year political cycles. And we can't fight long wars. We don't have the patience. Therefore, we should avoid them. I'll say as a counter to that, you know, we're still in Afghanistan. We've been there since 2001. So I think we can fight these kind of wars, but it is hard to put a lot of resources there for a very long time. The argument that's most successful has been this dangerous argument, that if you focus too much on counterinsurgency, you're going to lose your important conventional skills. It may also make leaders too overconfident with counterinsurgency, which is very expensive. And really, that is, in my view, the most dominant argument in Washington right now, that there is counterinsurgency fatigue. Nobody wants to do it anymore. The 2012 defense planning guidance from President Obama said, we're not going to do long-term COIN anymore. I'll talk some about that a little bit at the end. And there's one of the four services who remain nameless said the doctrine neglected air power too much. Now, we're going to talk a lot of it today about the surge in Iraq, which is really where the doctrine gets applied. There are really four surges, not just one. And I remember sitting down with General Petraeus in February 2007 before he went to Iraq to talk about these. There was a military surge. The extra troops made it much easier for the Petraeus Odierno team to do combat operations around Baghdad. There also needed to be an Iraqi political will surge. A lot of that came just from the announcement of the surge, and they knew the Americans were there to stay. Most of the impact in Anbar province, for instance, happens even before we show up. But there's a sense that people feel they can rise up because we're going to be there to back them up. Michael O'Hanlon and Kenneth Pollack write a piece in late July 2007 in the New York Times that says the surge is working, which completely changed the tenor of the Democratic political debates. To be honest, FM 324 is a very powerful information tool as well. It helps convince our allies, enemies, Congress, the Army itself, the Marine Corps, that we now know how to fight this kind of war. The last one is a civilian surge, which I'm sure we'll talk about in some of our questions in the session with General Petraeus. At the tactical level, it was accomplished by sending the provincial reconstruction teams to brigades, assigning all those civilians to brigade commanders to take care of. Also, he and Ambassador Crocker did a lot of work with with Maliki and his government to get this to work as well. A lot of personal mentoring. One of the great tragedies when the new administration came in was all those connections went away. And that's one of the reasons why everything kind of went awry after the surge. Now, a lot of reasons for the awakening. Everybody knows about the Anbar awakening. It takes a certain amount of timing is important. In some ways, counterinsurgency is like a hockey fight. And you got to kind of wait for both sides to get worn out. You have all the hockey fans in the back there. But got to wait for both sides to get worn out, and then the referees can kind of step in and separate them. And there's some of that. The Sunnis realize they're losing, and the Sunnis realize they're going to have to figure out a better way maybe the Americans can help them, and we can be a friend. They have to be part of the solution. Al-Qaeda were inept insurgents. Maybe we get into some of the stories of that. We get into the question and answer. But Al-Qaeda did a lot of things to actually antagonize the Sunnis instead of getting their support. We got the new doctrine. We got the adaptation to dynamics. Immensely competent soldiers. Eventually, the Petraeus-Odierno actions forced Sadr's militia off the battlefield as well. But again, the gains fall apart when we leave. The American forces and American diplomats were the cement that was making the mosaic peace work. The surge creates a window for Iraq to reconcile, and for a number of reasons, and there's a lot of blame to go around, that political reconciliation does not happen. A few quick observations for Iraq. This is my mandatory, I know Dave Petraeus slide. Here we are. This is in his palace in Baghdad. The two young guys in the middle, that's me, and of course Dave, this old guy over here is John Martin, another classmate of ours, who you'll see on the panel with us. John was one of General Petraeus' key aides, and we had a little small reunion there in Baghdad, and that's in November 2007. Immense amount of work by brigade commanders over there. I mean, this is Ricky Gibbs, one of my students here at the War College, ran into him in Iraq. He was commanding a brigade of 10 battalions. That's a division-sized brigade. And his occupation zone included over 1 million Iraqis. This is a colonel with that kind of responsibility. Here he is opening up a hospital in a special ceremony in his zone in South Baghdad. One of the other Petraeus initiatives was to push the forces out of the forward operating bases into these combat outposts. This is Jurfash Shaker, one of those outposts. And here we are at the outpost with some of the key players. It's myself, General Huntoon, going on to be the Director of Army Staff. Steve Biddle, also here from Carlisle. That's Colonel Mike Garrett, eventually General Garrett, who is in command of the brigade in that sector. This is another people you'll see on your panel today. This is Lieutenant Colonel Bo Balcavage, commander of the 1st of the 501st Airborne Infantry at Jurfash Shaker. And this is his A Company commander, John Henry Moltz. And they were all talking to us about the operations they were doing. They also talked about these guys, the rise of the Sons of Iraq. This is a Sheikh Saba, who was in charge of the local militia that rose up to support the awakening, support our efforts against Al-Qaeda. I'm actually out of the picture of taking this with John Henry Moltz, and he's talking to me. He says, you know, I could swear some of those guys were shooting at me a couple months ago. And I said, Captain Moltz, welcome to counterinsurgency. Because that's what happens in this kind of war. People change sides. Now, the other thing we had to deal with, now, a lot of you people know General Huntoon. General Huntoon is not the slippery character I'm talking about here. It's this guy, Al-Balani, who is the interior minister, of the Iraqi interior minister. Very, you know, the interior ministry was rife with sectarianism, death squads. We had to learn which of these people really are friends and which were not. I actually found we had more intelligence on our friends than our enemies in most cases. You had to be really careful. And again, that's an issue we'll talk to more when we get into the question and answer and other things as well. We're very good at training the Iraqi army, not so good at reforming the police. This is General Hussein, who actually was a key factor in trying to reform the national police, firing a lot of the sectarian Shiite commanders, bringing in more competent people. He was a real hero among the Americans. One of the first things that happens when we pull out and leave is Maliki will kick him upstairs, appoint him to be commander of the border posts over there, and all the sectarians return. And national police goes back the way it was, and the sectarian strife ignites again. But for a brief shining Camelot kind of moment, there was a lot of great reform going on in police. In this kind of warfare, police are often more important than the military. We also did a lot of interesting things behind the wire at the detention camps. Counterinsurgency did not stop when people were put into detention. There was a lot of work done to reform the captives, teach them how to read, teach them a modern form of Islam, give them job skills, and send them back. The ones that were reconcilable. The irreconcilables you want to lock away forever. But most of them you could actually reconcile. And they were actually doing what one of their officers called firing moderate missiles back into Iraqi society with these detainees that they reformed. Actually, when I was over there, they had sent 2,200 back. They had a grand total of 2 come back. Any prison in the United States would relish that kind of recidivism rate. They also had to do like new courts and legal reform. And that's, they had to change the whole Iraqi legal system and speed it up to give people quicker trials and change the whole way they looked at justice. And the Iraqi legal system started as, what you did is you beat a confession out of people, and then you, the rest of the trial was trying to, he was trying to convince you he really didn't mean it. And basically we shifted it to a more adversarial system like we are, where you had to prove things, more forensics, basically shifted their style. We also did a lot of barriers and movement control. We imposed a lot of sectarian divides in Iraqi cities. One of the sad spin-offs of the kind of warfare we fought. Put up a lot of walls, split up a lot of neighborhoods, but that became the only way to secure a lot of the Shiite and Sunni neighborhoods. Baghdad today is no longer as multicultural as it was when this war started. This is the nature of the warfare. We also had to learn to accept local solutions. This is Al-Zabai near Basra, sitting around talking with their town council. This is the Sunni sheikh. This is the local Shiite. They basically got along fine as long as they had a military presence to help secure them from ourselves and the Brits. But again, we had to let them come up with their solution because ours didn't always fit. It tended to be very slower. It tended to be very hard to understand sometimes for us. A lot of deal making in the background, but it worked for them. Now, we talked about the fact that a lot of this fell apart and we withdrew. I'll show you a picture here in a minute. One of the realities is if you want to achieve national objectives with American military interventions, you're always going to be there a long time. You're always going to be there a long time. You don't go into Bosnia in 6 months like President Clinton said. You're not going to go into Iraq in 3 months like Secretary Rumsfeld expected. It's always going to take a long time. We're still in Japan. We're still in Germany. We're still in Korea today. We're still in the Balkans. Korea is an example. It took 30 years for democracy to appear in Korea. Now, if anybody's been following the news lately, you can argue whether it's survived or not and what's been going on the last few weeks. There were local ceasefire agreements. They all started to unravel without our presence. The diplomatic withdrawal was just as important as the military withdrawal. All the connections with the ministry started to break down. Maliki was let loose to do a lot to return to his sectarian predilections. There actually was orders that came out of the new administration that went out to ambassadors to not to be as subservient as Ryan Crocker was to General Petraeus. When in reality, they were working very closely together, but the new administration saw that as the State Department being subservient to the Defense Department. And ambassadors were instructed to be more independent. I mean, that's one of the more nonsensical things that came out of the new administration when they came on early. We know the country is fractured today, but again, I'd say this is a failure of foreign policy, not a counterinsurgency. You can argue all you want about that, but I think that there's, again, all the military can do is provide the window for political opportunity, and that was squandered by a lot of blame to go on both sides why that got squandered. Part of the problem, the ideal view of transition is that military goes in for one of these occupations or one of these contingencies. There's a handover point where civilian organizations, the UN, takes over, and eventually then they will hand over responsibility to the host nation, which rises up and rejoins the community of nations. Reality is that the civilian organizations don't have the capacity. Military carries the main burden until they reach a handover point, and that tends to be a long way down the road. That's just the reality of things. Again, military interventions, you're going to be there a long time, and the military is going to end up doing a lot of things they'd rather not do because they don't have civilian capacity to do them. This is an example of this. This is how many years we are in places after military interventions. And some of these, I think, are too low. The bottom line is, if you're going to consolidate your gains beyond armed conflict, you're going to be there a long time. If you get out of there in 10 years, you're lucky. It usually takes longer than that. Now, we got a few things wrong in the doctrine. We were not perfect, as much as we hoped we were. The development process is upside down. The doctrine should come from national security policy. You should start with national security strategy, which develops national military strategy, which develops joint doctrine, which develops service doctrine. We did this upside down. We developed service doctrine that eventually became our national security strategy. It was not intended to be that, but just there was a vacuum intended to fill. Counterinsurgency was oversold. It's not a strategy. Counterinsurgency is a way to do things. It's not a strategy. You've got to have something else involved that's your overall, that sets your ends. And your ends are normally set by politicians and voters, not by the military. And the most important decisions in COIN are made by politicians and voters. The military had no say in the form of government in Iraq or Afghanistan or who the leaders were. That was decided from other people. And those are the main determinants of success in these kind of wars. And oh, by the way, the goals of these host nation leaders are unfortunately often very different from ours. That was one of the big things. When we wrote the doctrine, we made an assumption that the people we're supporting, the leaders the country we're supporting, had the same interests that we do. That's not true. We've found that out the hard way, both in Iraq and Afghanistan. It makes these kind of wars a lot harder to fight. The other thing is also, clear, hold, and build is very expensive and very time-consuming. And we didn't have time in the manual to come up with alternative approaches. Some of the new doctrine since has, but that was a shortcoming of the manual. And so there was a lot of learning and adapting going on in the field as people figured out other ways to do things with fewer resources. Now, some observations. I got a couple slides of observations. I'm not going to have any time for questions, but those will come out in the next couple hours as we go through the session with General Petraeus and others. In modern warfare, conflict termination has become very, very difficult because you've got multiple enemies. I see another guy, Steve Metz, here and up here. He's another guy who influences very heavily. We stole a lot of his ideas as well, so there's more blame. I can spread more blame in this room. Conflict termination is very, very difficult. Complex set of enemies, complex set of friends, trying to get everybody to agree. In some of these situations, all you can do is manage the violence. You might never be able to fix it. Again, we still don't have enough interagency capability, which means the military ends up doing a lot of things it doesn't want to do. These decapitation counterterrorism strategies are a two-edged sword. They can work for you or against you. One of the problems I saw talking with some of the people doing some of these counterterror strikes is we finally find an enemy leader we could talk to, and you'd get killed by a drone strike. And the guy who replaced them was an idiot fanatic who nobody could talk to, so you lost that avenue. So it's, you know, one of the reasons we don't bomb the Emperor's Palace in Tokyo in World War II, because we figure we need somebody to help us with the surrender at the end, which turns out to be true. So killing all the enemy leaders doesn't always work for you. But again, we know legitimacy doesn't grab an American gun. I talked about the fact you've got to be able to deal with, disaggregate your friends and figure out who your real friends are as well as your enemies. And sometimes they switch. You know, in regular wars, if you think you're winning, you might be. If you think you're losing, you are. And that's one of the realities as well. One of the things for airstrikes and special forces strikes, it controls the ground, controls the message. If you go in someplace, do a temporary strike and leave, the bad guys are going to shape the image of what happens. That's happened to us in Iraq and Afghanistan. The enemy is very, very capable of information warfare to try to negate our technological advantages. Who controls the ground, controls the message. And this is one of the problems. I talk a lot about this in the book. Special forces has gone way too much towards the size of direct action and forgotten a lot of the other missions it used to do, which were the Foreign Internal Defense Security Force Assistant. Those used to be special forces missions. They're still important, but nobody really wants to do them, the advisory missions. We're still fighting one-year wars. We still have problems with our rotation policy. Instead of doing one-year wars by individual, now we're doing one-year wars by units, but we still have the same transition problems, and I read about a lot of those in the book as well. And precision's not always the answer. You know, we love our precision munitions, but every so often you need to hammer people. I'm a big B-52 fan. And every so often, B-52s are what you want and not a single JDAM. So you need to think about how you apply force. Last thing, dilemmas of counterinsurgency. Again, these are some of the points I try to make in the book. Some of the things I'm sure we'll talk about today. And political leaders have got to be honest up front. If we are going to go into a country and use military force, we're going to be there a long time. That's the way it always is. If you want to meet national objectives, they're going to be long and costly. And I don't know if we get a political leader to be honest with that up front. I'm sure if President Bush had got up and said, We're going to invade Iraq today. I expect we're going to be there for 10 years. It's going to cost us so many trillions of dollars and 4,000 people. It's probably not going to get support for it. You understand that. But at least that to be honest to say that this is going to be a long-term. We can't lock ourselves into a timeline. One of the reasons that the surge in Afghanistan fails is because we announced the surge with a timeline. It's So all the Afghans say, okay, so you're going to be here how long? And then you're going to leave, and the Taliban are still going to be here? I mean, deadlines are, there are arguments on both sides on deadlines, but in my view, I think there's more negative than positive. You know, and this goes back to some of the critics of counterinsurgency. Just because you can do counterinsurgency doesn't mean that you should. And that's one of the problems that we ran into in the last decade, perhaps. But just because you say you're doing counterinsurgency doesn't mean that you are. And I would argue that we never did do counterinsurgency in Afghanistan. We never committed the resources to it. We never committed the money to it. We never committed the effort to it. That was a real lost opportunity, because we had run the Taliban out of Afghanistan in 2002, and we sat around for 4 years, did nothing, let them come back. And that was a real lost opportunity. Again, I mentioned the most important decisions affecting counterinsurgency are made by politicians and voters and not generals. It goes back to this quote I got from General Barbaro, who was General Petraeus' J3 operations officer in Baghdad when I interviewed him back in 2007. I don't know if we have the wrong form of government or the wrong people in it, talking about Iraq. And again, the dilemma for us in the military is neither of those things are within our purview. They're not in our control. You know, the form of government in Baghdad and in Kabul was the military didn't have any say in that, nor do we have any say in who was chosen to lead those governments. You have to play with the hand you're dealt. And I think in both cases, we had a pretty bad hand to deal with. And General Petraeus, I'm sure, will talk about some of the masterful ways he dealt with the hand that he had and some of the ways they worked with Maliki and tried to shape that government. But it's a tough game to play. And without Ryan Crocker's, the State Department's assistance, it wouldn't have been gone as well as it did. Again, what I mentioned is much of what we label as counterinsurgency is really just modern war. We're not going to be able to escape these dilemmas wherever we go, wherever we're going to run into these kind of dilemmas again and again and again in modern warfare. That's just the way it is. Warfare has gotten complex. We want to make it high tech, and our enemies are going to turn it the other way. You know, another one of my famous sayings, there are two kinds of warfare, asymmetric and stupid. And our stupid enemy, which is Iraq, is no longer out there. So now we've got a bunch of people who are going to do things asymmetric and try to negate all the things we like to do, all the things we're good at, they're going to try to negate those. Whether it's by hiding among the populace, going to regular warfare, crashing all our cyber stuff, blinding us with our space capabilities, we're going to have to learn to fight unplugged, in the dark, disconnected, with things that were in situations that are still going to take a nasty soldier with a bayonet. It's just the future war. We can talk about it as a video game. It's not, and our enemy is going to make sure it's not. And again, the other thing that I point out, you have to work on the semantics of this. But I came up with this after the 2012 defense planning guidance came out that said that we weren't going to do long-term stability operations or counterinsurgency again. And I said, we have never been able to never do this again. It can work the semantics. That worked? That worked, Samantha? I was pretty proud of that. I thought that came out pretty well. Okay, like I said, I think what we'll do is if you have any questions for me, we can keep those for when we have the actual session with General Petraeus. If I understand now, we're going to take about a 10-minute break.
All right, for the next two sections, we're going to start out with I'm going to turn it over to Dr. Crane again, a discussion between our panelists and, of course, Dr. Crane and General Petraeus. And then after that, we'll get into the Q&A. Again, when we do get to the Q&A, please wait for myself or one of my colleagues to come around with the microphone so that we can make sure we get your voices on the recording. And with that, Dr. Crane.
Thank you very much. I'm going to start out. I'm going to introduce our three panelists before I get to General Petraeus. Getting ready to grill General Petraeus, or whichever way you want to term it.
No enhanced interrogation technique.
No waterboarding.
I have opposed those all along.
First will be our classmate, Colonel Retired John Martin. I consider John, if you read my book, I consider John one of those iron colonels who really made our effort the last decade 15 years possible, 2 tours in Afghanistan, 2 tours in Iraq, a couple of those after he was retired.
Three in Iraq. He tried to do one in Iraq, and then I extended him for another year or so, and then what was really remarkable and truly selfless was that he came back on active duty and served another year at least during the surge and was a huge right hand for me during that period.
It just couldn't bear to get the uniform off. But, so John will be, he'll be free. He's currently retired, enjoying life, and preparing our class of 1974 soiree for this evening. Next will be the Dean of the U.S. Army War College, Colonel retired, Dr. Richard Lacquement. Another former officer, spent time in Afghanistan as a planner, but most known to me because he was, again, one of the key authors of the new counterinsurgency doctrine, who had the joyous task of trying to integrate all the interagency into what we were trying to do. And I'm sure he'll want to pursue that a bit in the questioning.
And who selflessly joined us in Iraq in the very first summer, didn't
you? Yes,
you were with Mike Meese when, you know, I needed a couple more Princeton PhDs up in Mosul. It worked great as long as we had the PhDs there. Unfortunately, it got a little tougher after that. But great to see you again, Richard.
Yeah, we had a continuing debate about, you know, the Stanford of the East and all these people from Stanford of the East involved. And, of course, he also calls Stanford the Princeton of the West. So we've had our discussions about this.
Stanford was created because everybody couldn't get into Princeton.
And last but not least on the group will be Colonel Bo Balcavage, who's Chief of Staff here at the U.S. Army War College right now. Again, distinguished military career, but most relevant for this audience, he is another one of the stars of my book, as are the other two, that as the commander of the 1st Battalion, 501st Airborne Infantry, Geronimo, in that triangle of death in Iraq during the surge. And he's got some very interesting stories that come out in the book. And then last of this group, definitely not least, my general retired David Petraeus. His most important role, of course, is my classmate and John's classmate. Besides that, he's done a number of things in his military career. Of course, he's commanded in Iraq, you know, commanded forces in Iraq, commanded forces in Afghanistan, was the central commander, commanded Central Command, director of the CIA. Currently, he's trying to give me a list of the things he is right now, and I don't have enough paper to fill them out. So he's a partner of KKR, one of the largest private equity investment firms in the world, with over $100 billion in assets. He is chairman of the KKR Global Institute. He is has a chair at the University of Southern California. He's a fellow at Harvard, among other things. So he has found some other things to do since he's taken the uniform off that we can all be envious of. And it's only fair that we give him a chance to open up with some comments about, so he can now rebut all the things that I said in the last hour, or perhaps add to them. But he made some real sacrifices to get here, and I'm glad we have a pretty good turnout. And hopefully the jet lag won't get to him too much. We actually just drove him up from Dulles Airport to be here. So. He really is great. We appreciate very much him being here. And, sir, the floor is yours.
I thank you, Con. It's a privilege to be here to help you shill shamelessly for your book.
I was hiding that for later.
There are a few people for whom I'd cut short a visit to London to come back to Carlisle, Pennsylvania for a Saturday afternoon. And thanks to all of you for joining us for this. It actually is a privilege to be here with Con and with the others. Con, I think, truly made singular and unique contributions, not just in being the editor-in-chief of the Counterinsurgency Field Manual and sort of shepherding that process through, being in many cases the foil for me. You know, he pointed out these issues that were big issues, and I was muttering back in the back with some others who are both one of our classmates back there that, you know, they were not really big issues for me. I hate to say it, Con, but, you know, I just sort of let you fight them out to try to get everybody spent. And, you know, once they were all sort of exhausted, I'd then just make a decision and everybody would salute and we would carry on.
I did win one or two of those arguments, not many, but one or two.
I do want to thank Colonel Cream and the whole team for this great institution right here. It's been, I think it's a decade since I was last out here. The development is extraordinary, very, very impressive, and I congratulate everybody on what they have done to get it to this point. I do want to single out Bill Rapp, Major General Bill Rapp, who is here in the back right there. Thank you, our commandant. And again, not just for what he's doing right now and what we hope he may do and all the rest, but actually for incredibly selflessly turning right around. He'd just gotten home from Iraq in November of 2006 or December. I remember calling him right after I was announced to be nominated to command the surge and asking him if he'd consider coming back to Baghdad to be the chief of the Commander's Initiatives Group, which he did. Over time, I don't think there's a single Rhodes Scholar in the Army, Navy, Air Force, Marines, or even probably Coast Guard for that matter, that didn't serve for Bill, were preparing to serve for Bill, or were recovering from serving for Bill. But we had a list of all the bright folks, and he did a masterful job pulling together a lot of the different elements that were so critical to the effort to oversee the surge, to communicate the results of it truthfully and effectively. We used to say, be first with the truth, and so on. We have a number of members of Class of 74 here. It's remarkable that they're not drinking beer already at this hour on a Saturday afternoon. But if the pride of the Corps who are here with us could please stand up just so we can recognize all of them. Thank you so much for joining us. We will be drinking beer later on at J.R. Martin's house, but first, this more important stuff. Of course, we have a number of students in the audience from the U.S. Army War College. I was distressed to learn as I was driving through the War College toward where I thought the location was going to be, having completely disregarded the address that was on my digital calendar, to go over to the auditorium there where, you know, everything always happens. But as I drove through there and noticed that there is no longer a Smurf Village, I was very disturbed by this. It triggered all kinds of things, and I don't know how students possibly can get the character-building experience that was so notable about Carlisle Barracks without that. I guess I would want to start out, if I could, by noting that, try to put this into perspective, because the surge that mattered most was actually not the surge of forces, and one of the tendencies of some folks in academic communities and elsewhere is to say, well, the surge was the 25 or 30,000 extra forces that we were provided, but it was really all the other stuff that actually proved to generate success. Well, the surge that mattered most was not the surge of forces, it was the surge of ideas. It was the change in strategy. And by the way, how many here actually were in the surge? Thank you for that. It was a very, very tough time. And, you know, people often ask me, you know, what was it like to command the surge? What a wonderful experience. It was a grinding endeavor. And everybody who was part of it will, I'm sure, affirm that to you. But the surge of ideas was what really mattered. And these ideas were 180 degrees different from the ideas that were guiding the strategy before, which the previous commander and previous ambassador actually signed a document back in December of that year saying that essentially that the strategy was failing to achieve its intended results in each of the different areas, including security, of their civil military campaign plan. And you know, those of us who had been back in the States, who had participated in this effort to bring our intellectual capital together and to develop concepts on which we could develop a campaign plan, knew that we needed to change the big ideas very substantially. And I'll go through a number of these fairly quickly. The first is that the human terrain is a decisive terrain. Now, don't get me wrong, the terrain in Afghanistan can be pretty decisive when you're at 10,000 feet altitude with 100 pounds on your back, but the point was that it was all about the population. Now, I agree, this is not just population-centric. You have to be population-centric, enemy-centric, all these other elements-centric, but the point was that you had to secure the people, and if you didn't have security of the people, nothing else was achievable. You couldn't, you were building on a shaky foundation. And the bottom line there was that the only way to secure the people was to live with them. And you mentioned this, but that had huge implications. In fact, it had 77 massive implications just in the multinational division Baghdad area alone, where we created 77 additional locations where our forces were located, joint security stations, combat outposts, in some cases actual forward operating bases, with Iraqis generally, and most of these required a serious fight to establish. But once they were in a location for a week or so, the transformation really began, and the people would start to come to them and say, look, we have a tip, here's where the bad guy is. They realize that we're going to live with them. And prior to that, we had been consolidating on big bases throughout 2006, handing off to the Iraqis prematurely, basically driving through the neighborhood a couple of times a day, and then being back on the big base at night. There was logic to this, don't get me wrong. The problem was that that logic was undone by the events of 22 February 2006 and the subsequent spiral of violence afterward. That was the bombing of a holy Shia shrine at Samarra, which was inside a Sunni Arab area, so that made it even more particularly sensitive. So pulling out of these neighborhoods, handing off to Iraqis, ultimately the Iraqis could not sustain the results that had been achieved. And that's really the second big idea, and that was that the Iraqi security forces just were not capable of doing what was expected of them. They'd been beaten up, they'd been intimidated, they'd been corrupted, they'd been again rendered incapable of accomplishing the mission that they had. And so from that big idea comes the realization that we have to take over control. And of course, that's also facilitated by moving back into the neighborhoods. The third was that you had to clear and hold, build, and transition. And you had this among the points that you made. But what we had been doing in 2006, and again, to be fair, prior to realizing that the strategy is being undone by the violence that's growing, and it took a number of months into that year to get that, I must confess that the light came on for me back in the United States, and I would go through the battlefield update and analysis on the secure internet that we had. But I remember reading an article that was in the New York Times, I think in August of 2006, and it was titled, Driving Around Baghdad Waiting to Get Blown Up. And this is the way a sergeant described what he was doing at that time. And I said, wow, because we'd lived with the people in Mosul in 2003. We'd done reconciliation, another big idea. A lot of these had been done by various elements. Famously known, H.R. McMaster did it in Tal Afar in 2004 and 5, I think it was. The Marines did it in various places. So again, but we realized we needed to do this overall. So you not only had to clear and hand off, which is what we did with Together Forward 1 and Together Forward 2, big operations in the fall of 2006, which were intended to drive the level of violence down. They did. But then it went up again once we handed off to the Iraqi forces, again, unfortunately, prematurely. The fourth big idea was that you could not kill or capture your way out of an industrial strength insurgency. I constantly was asked by members of Congress in particular, but why can't we just do JSOC Delta Force SEAL Team 6 raids until all the bad guys are gone? And the answer is because there's far more of them than we can ever kill in these raids. In fact, Stan McChrystal used to use Ramadi as an example, this famously difficult city. Took us several months to clear, even after we began it with U.S. forces a month or so into the surge. But as he would recount, we were doing multiple raids every single night in Ramadi for the period of a couple of years. And the violence kept getting worse. And the reason was, of course, because until you took away the areas that they were using, until you cleared and held, and then, by the way, imposed population control measures. You know, we gave them gated communities free of charge. It cost a lot of money in the States to get what we put T-walls around. until you actually took control of that area, you could raid all night long and it would never happen. And I'll show you later a particular slide that captures all of this that I actually used with Congress to illustrate why you couldn't just kill or capture your way out of it. It took a comprehensive effort. So if you can't kill or capture, what do you do? You promote reconciliation. Again, not a novel, completely novel idea, but one that we'd never pursued in a hugely aggressive, intensive manner, nor one that was facilitated by a pledge that we could make legitimately that we could secure the population if they would come on our side, if they would support the new Iraq instead of continuing to oppose it or tacitly or actively assisting the Sunni insurgents. Now, although we recognize we couldn't kill or capture our way out of an industrial strength insurgency, we had to promote reconciliation. By the way, ultimately, we reconciled with something like 103,000 Sunni Arabs, the bulk of them, 80,000 or so Sunni Arabs, and then the rest were Shia Arab militias, which people also forget. We had a dual problem, which we can talk about in a bit if you want. But we also did pursue the irreconcilables even more aggressively. So we did actually dramatically increase the number of raids that General McChrystal's and then Admiral McRaven's forces were conducting to the tune of about 10 to 15 of these very precise, intelligence-driven, high-risk raids that did make a huge difference, but if and only if you were actually taking advantage of those to clear areas, hold them, and then turn them against the enemy. There was certainly an awareness, as Con mentioned earlier, that you had to conduct counterinsurgency inside the wire in our detention facilities as well as outside the wire. In other words, you had to identify the irreconcilables, you had to remove them from the general population, put them in maximum security, and then you had to have a review process and a rehabilitation process for the remainder. And in fact, I stopped releasing detainees, which was 180 degrees from what was going on before. And all of these, by the way, were contrary to Prime Minister Nouri al-Maliki's desires, as his national security advisor informed me in the first week that I was back there. But you had to do that, or else you were running a terrorist training university, as Stan McChrystal labeled Camp Buka. By the way, this sounds small. This was not a minor problem. Once we stopped releasing detainees, we reached 27,000 Iraqi detainees, 27,000 before I ultimately allowed the release to resume once we had rehabilitation and training and moderation and so forth classes for them. And lo and behold, the recidivism rate, the return to insurgency or crime went down by something like over 90%. So it was quite dramatic as well. Now, also, they were going back to communities now that by and large were much more peaceful, where they could indeed support the new Iraq and had incentives to do so instead of to oppose it. And then finally, that we had to pursue even greater civil-military integration than we had before. Now, to be fair to General Casey and Ambassador Khalilzad, they had, first of all, established a very sound civil-military approach, albeit with big ideas that we were going to pursue with the surge being quite a bit different. That also, and one of the important contributions that General Casey made was to completely redo the organizational architecture after he took over from 2004 until early 2007 when I assumed command from him. So we had basically a sound organizational architecture on which to build. This is not trivial. You've got to get that right in addition to obviously getting the mission statement and the various campaign plan ideas right as well. Finally, let me point out also that there has been a dramatic revolution in recent years that actually enables us to do what a counterinsurgency campaign calls for. And by the way, I should just note, all a counterinsurgency campaign is everything, it's just a descriptor. It is merely the way you label a campaign. It is not, there is no, again, within that, you are still conducting offensive, defensive, and stability operations, which you do in any military operation. You know, at the same time that we did the counterinsurgency field manual, we finalized FM 3.0, in which we, the most important big idea of all was this idea that you're never going to have a campaign that does not also include stability operations, albeit you might be emphasizing offensive very heavily or defensive or stability. And that is actually the challenge for the Army today. We have to be ready to do it all. And I might show a spectrum slide that sort of speaks to what I'm getting at, and even show that even in Iraq at various points in time, I mean, those who say, well, we were losing our edge in combat, clearly weren't there for the Battle of Fallujah or the Battle of Ramadi or the battles of various parts of Baghdad or Samarra or Mosul or all. These were serious big battles, or especially perhaps the Battle of Sadr City, which was taken a year into the surge when we had a major fight on our hands finally with the Shia militia, something that we had sought to postpone and indeed did, and sort of intimidated them into standing down the first summer, which helped not only our statistics, but the state of security as we pursued and focused on the Sunni Arab part of that problem. But we now have an ability, because of the dramatic advances in intelligence, surveillance, and reconnaissance assets, many of them unmanned. Predators and Reapers are the coin of the realm, really. We never got to the 75 orbits, simultaneous orbits, that Secretary Gates and I thought were needed. I think we're somewhere in the neighborhood of 60 to 65. Those are extraordinary capabilities. They, with our precision munition, and then the one that's most overlooked is the industrial strength ability to fuse intelligence, also developed actually during the surge by another one of our classmates with his help, the NSA director, Keith Alexander, at the time, when we realized we had so much data, we couldn't shove it all through the pipes that we had to transmit it back to NSA or the intelligence community in the state, so we had to build our own, what we now call a cloud, to do the storage, and then we brought the applications engineers out to Baghdad, and we were turning applications on these software apps that enabled us to take everything digitized, analyze it, and make sense out of it. By the way, I should just note that productivity out there was extraordinary. It's amazing what you can get out of people if they work 7 days a week, you know, 16, 18 hours a day, aren't being asked when they're going to be home for dinner, and above all, can't drink. It was really quite remarkable. But we are now able, and we are demonstrating this in Iraq in particular, there because we had a lot left over to work with. As abysmal as the performance of the ISF, the Iraqi security forces, was when the Islamic State rolled back into Anbar province and then northern Iraq, there still was lots left, infrastructure, institutions, command and control, weapon systems, training bases, forward operating bases, all the rest of that, albeit having lost a shameful amount in the process. But this is enabling us now to do with advise and assist elements, train and equip, some counterterrorism, and then this armada of enablers to carry out a civil military counterinsurgency campaign, but without us being the ones to do the fighting on the front lines, frankly, the fighting and dying, at much, much less cost. I mean, we're doing with under 6,000 troops in Iraq some very, very impressive work, and with them doing the bulk of the other tasks. And so perhaps I might just end by showing a slide that depicts what it is that we were trying to do in Iraq back in 2007, 2008, and frankly, what we're now doing, enabling Iraqis to do in Iraq, and which we're trying to do with nascent Syrian forces, trying to sustain with Afghan forces. And we had, by the way, we have versions of this for Afghanistan, and also, for what it's worth, Colombia and Mexico and a few other places around the world, where we've been asked for advice over the years. So we could put the Anaconda strategy, which is actually slide four. It's called squeezing the life out of the AQI. There we go.
Yep.
I'm going to get up, and I don't know if you can all see over this way, maybe, and be, you know, I feel empowered again to have PowerPoint and a laser pointer. I mean, you know, it's the inalienable right. There's something, you know, in your First Amendment rights, there's a little asterisk, and it goes down to the bottom. It says, Army general officers are authorized to express their freedom of expression with PowerPoint slides and a laser pointer. But so we created this slide. I created it back in, I think it was August of 2007. And I did it because Congress, as I mentioned earlier, was beating me up about why we couldn't win the war against these elements. Now, this is the Sunni Arabs. By the way, we also had a Shia Arab one. And so to orient you on this slide, they wanted us to win the war with this element right here. And of course, these were the enemies. So you had Al-Qaeda in Iraq. There was, this was another Sunni Arab insurgent group. There are various affiliates of that in Iraq in this 20% of the population that was Sunni battling against the majority that were now ruling the country. So we tried to lay out here what they needed. Obviously, weapons, foreign fighters was a huge element, by the way, so we had to stop that flow over time. We did take away their safe havens within the country, battled them for this, fought against this and did a pretty good job of it, disrupted, and then ultimately defeated their command and control money. And they had to have, again, some overall senior leader, this is from Pakistan, guidance that was coming to them. We tried to cut those lines as well. I'd also add that they needed explosives. This is all in this area here. Explosives and explosives expertise are particularly important elements in a war where improvised explosive devices were such a tool of the enemy. So what we wanted to do was take all this away from them. And we did it by squeezing the life out of the Sunni insurgents. And the way to do that is with an all-of-the-above comprehensive civil-military counterinsurgency campaign. Now, this is actually what Iraq was being done in Iraq today. All these elements are there. The difference is that you don't have 165,000 U.S. conventional forces on the ground and another 20,000 coalition in addition to the Iraqi forces. Depicted here. So you don't have those. You do have some of these, although they're certainly not doing 10 to 15 ops a night, although they're doing a number with intelligence, surveillance, and reconnaissance precision fires, and occasionally putting boots on the ground in an actual operation with Iraqis. These would be broken out, actually, because this is an element that has proven to be extraordinarily capable, even in the face of the Islamic State. There are police as well as Army Special Operations Forces. And although they have been, they've taken very high casualties, 40 to 50%, including wounded as well. And then this was the reconciliation product, the Sons of Iraq program that came out of this particular element here. But my point to Congress was not only do you need these other elements of military activity and police as well, so not just kinetics, you need all of this other activity as well. Politics is hugely important. You had to do this reconciliation piece, as I mentioned, and then probably should break this out because this is a separate element, laws and policies. And this is an area where we did actually achieve some progress, but where the intent of the laws and policies was over time was not implemented. Prime Minister Maliki, in particular, in late 2011, basically refusing to honor agreements that had been made that were so important to reaching reconciliation as we went along. The tribal awakenings were a spin out of reconciliation, hugely important to get a shake in his entire tribe to turn against Al-Qaeda and the Sunni Arab insurgent elements. And then you had to constantly battle this. You had not just sectarian between Sunni and Shia Arab, you also had Arab Kurd, and by the way, you see those very prominently now in Iraq. But all these are still going on to some degree. There actually are still awakenings going on, and sheikhs are still leading these courageously. Intelligence, massively important. This is an intelligence-driven endeavor, and so that's why that was so key. I mentioned detainee ops, the coin inside the facility, and then enormous care before you actually release the detainee. You put them back with a link to his sheikh, his tribe, a formal ceremony to denote his return to the civil population, and a judicial element there as well. Non-kinetics are crucial. Once you have security, you can build on it, and you solidify security by building all these other elements right here. And then, of course, the whole overall effort of strategic communications, source countries, you know, not let military-age males take a one-way ticket to Damascus, Syria, where they would enter the Al-Qaeda pipeline, go into Iraq and blow themselves up or fight us. This is a more prominent element now, internet Cyberspace is an entire new battlefield domain, as you know well. And then we had big ideas for this, as I mentioned, first with the truth and that kind of thing. So this just sort of captures the overarching construct. Maybe we could go to one other slide before I open myself to the interrogators here. That would be slide number one, please. So this puts all this in perspective. Again, all counterinsurgency is just a campaign description, and it is describing warfare that's generally in this area right here. So it's not at the very high end of major combat, although, you know, don't tell that to a brigade combat team commander who's engaged in really serious fighting, such as in Sadr City or Ramadi. We had a diagram that showed what the brigade commander controlled for the Battle of Sadr City, and it was more unmanned aerial vehicles than any commander had ever controlled in Army history. And of course, they've proliferated very much since then. So that was major combat operations. He controlled everything from individual snipers, special forces snipers, through light infantry, through Bradley fighting vehicles, M1 tanks. Then he had towers with optics, blimps with optics, unmanned aerial vehicles with optics, attack helicopters, orbiting close air support, unmanned aerial vehicles with precision munitions, all the way up actually to U-2s flying over to try to pick up unique stuff. Don't tell me that is not combat operations, albeit maybe not an armored brigade box formation in a desert, such as we were able to do in say, in the Gulf War. But the real insight here is that, again, it's always somewhere on this spectrum, and it always includes all of these. And I think the revolution in thinking back in 2006, 2007 with the FM 3.0 was that this is always present. You are always going to have to do stability operations. So the idea that we could return to that ideal scenario that we used to fight out at the National Training Center and then did for record in the Gulf War with Colonel Cream and others who were in here, I mean, that was sent from central casting for us. There's no civilians, there's no villages, it's just tank on tank. And as H.R. McMaster later, you know, masterfully put it, I mean, that's just plain stupid to take on the United States in that, and we will not see it again. But somewhere in here, you have to be ready for all of these. And what you're going to do, obviously, with the readiness system is tilt it one way or the other, depending on what it is you think a unit might do. And then if it actually receives orders and you can get into a sustainable preparation, you set them on a road to deployment that prepares them properly for what it is you think they will most likely face. Let's go to the next slide, because it is instructive to remember that even in, this is in the early days, level of violence was much lower. But that was when we carried out a Battle of Fallujah right here that was enormous. So the point of this slide was from the operational level down to say that although the descriptor, if you will, was counterinsurgency, if you look at the Marines, Multinational Force West, and by the way, at that time it also included these southern Shia cities in addition to Anbar Province, all Sunni Arab. Their focus, the way they would describe what they were doing, was offense, 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 because they're massing four or five brigade combat teams to fight for the city of Fallujah, 300 or so thousand people. And for them, defense was rather minor, and stability was also, except that they were doing that. And I actually have a blow up, which we didn't put in this slide deck, that shows Multinational Force West at that time. That one two-star division commander, at that time, actually three-star, one Marine Expeditionary Force, was doing major stability operations over here in Najaf and the other holy city, Karbala, of the Shia, which we had taken that summer. Major combat operation around Anbar, and then everywhere else was on the defensive. So again, always doing a mix of all these. And you can see basically the point of this slide was that you have to be able to do it all at any given time. You're always going to be doing some mix. And then let's go to this final slide, because this was instructive about when I took over the Combined Arms Center and we were starting into FM 3.0, this is what was originally sent to me. And I'll give you a second to read that. And if you can do the next slide, that was what I did to that particular statement. And I would still submit that that is, although my understanding is, and you might check, Bill, that there is this kind of thinking is reemerging. That if you can do the big stuff, all this little stuff is lesser included tasks. It is not. You have to train for it, you have to be prepared for it, and if you are not, you fumble around the way we did for a number of years in Iraq before we realized that you had to not only do offensive and some defensive operations, you had to do stability. And the fact is that well-trained units that can fight and win in a general war are not able to do, quote, less combat intensive operations. So with that, you might go to the very last slide, number 9, and fire away.
Okay, I'm gonna take the prerogative of the chair here and ask the first question. And as I mentioned in my briefing, one of the assumptions we got wrong initially, most of the writing team had this sense that somehow the interest of the Iraqi elites would be the same as ours in the campaign to be commenced. And we, one of the things that everybody had to learn on the ground was no, especially Maliki's government had a very different idea on where things needed to go than we did, and sometimes we're more of a barrier than the Sunnis were. My question is you know, if you look at all the histories of American counterinsurgency, the biggest problem seems to be getting the people we're supporting to do what we think we need them to do. It seems to me that you and Ambassador Crocker had a great success with Prime Minister Maliki, and I was wondering what techniques you used for leverage to get him to do. I mean, I've heard some fascinating stories of Pete Mansour about what you did for police reform to persuade Maliki to remove allow some of the sectarians to be removed. I was just wondering what kind of leverage you used to get Prime Minister Maliki and his people to do what we thought they needed to do against what their interests had been.
Well, it's a wonderful question because we encountered this all the time. I mentioned earlier that we started off, I might even pace a little bit here since I was on a plane last night and all that stuff. First is another big idea about counterinsurgency is you don't actually get to choose your partners. You get the hand that you're dealt. Every now and then that might be like the Brits had in Oman, the perfect partner, Sultan Qaboos, brilliant guy, carried out a masterful civil military campaign. One of the British colonels at the time later wrote a book when he was a 4-star titled modestly, "We Want a War," Sir John Akerst. He was the Deputy Supreme Allied Commander at Europe when I was the SACEUR's speechwriter. Sometimes you get some other good ones, as the Brits had a couple of times over the years. Sometimes you get Prime Minister Maliki or, frankly, President Karzai. And at times like that, every now and then, you'd go to bed at night thinking, it's never good if I want it more than they do or seem to. But that's reality. Again, welcome to the real world. Welcome to the National Football League, as we used to say. And so the question was, how do you get done what you know needs to be done, even if, again, the leader may be against that? I was confronted in the third day, I think it was, that I was back in Iraq, or in command of the surge, by the National Security Advisor, who I knew very well from previous tours. And he said, now, General, there are a number of demands that the Prime Minister has. One is to continue to get out of the cities, out of the faces of the people. Number two was release detainees more quickly. Number three was hand off to the Iraqis more expeditiously. On and on. Every one of those, as I've explained earlier, was contrary to what we knew needed to be done and what we, in fact, were going to do. And that's a moment where you sort of get paid, I guess, for what you're supposed to do, and I said, with great respect, Doctor, if that is what Prime Minister Maliki intends to do, he should know that he ought to tell that to President Bush on the normally scheduled video teleconference that we have, which was usually once a week. We had one with the President once I got there, and Ambassador Crocker, we had one with the President 7:30 in the morning Eastern Standard Time, every Monday morning. If you were president and want to show your priority, that's a great way to do it. But then on Tuesdays, they'd have one with Prime Minister Maliki and the president. So I said, if it would be great if he would explain that to the president. But I said, before he does that, he does need to know that he will do that without me, because I will be on the next plane to Washington, and I intend to take the policy with me. And I actually meant that, and I did not sleep that night. I was on pins and needles the next day as the video conference warmed up and Prime Minister launched. I never heard another word about that during my subsequent 19 and a half months. Now, there were challenges along the way. You know, police reform, you mentioned. Well, I had enormous leverage on police reform. I just would refuse to reconstitute police forces until they fired the three-star at the top, both two-stars, all of the one-stars, all the brigade commanders. Their brigades were commanded by brigadiers, and somewhere around 70% of the lieutenant colonel battalion commanders. I knew these guys from the past. We'd started picking up toward the end of my three-star tour which ones were really quite beyond the pale. We had a lot more intelligence on them since that. And so we basically insisted on that, and very determinedly but quietly, and then he actually acceded to that. On reconciliation, I mean, there were some real high adventure moments, high drama moments in reconciliation, such as when I decided on my own, actually after talking to a major who happened to be brought over to run with me. You know, you're constantly trying to get a sense for what's going on out there. You're obviously going out to see units. We had a minimum of twice each week. We'd spend a whole day out with the unit, walk patrols, huddle with the battalion commander, the company commanders, ultimately get the captains together with no one else in the room and say, this is you are at the level where every casualty has a face as well as a name or a number, and you owe it to them to tell me right now if you've got something that's really eating at you that you're not getting satisfaction on. And they would, and I gave my email address in case they came up with something there. This is deadly serious for me, too. I did not go over there to lose gracefully. The worst I thought, if all else fails, you know, I'll quit and go home or something like that. But I did not hesitate to on occasion, use that kind of notion with folks above me. Because remember, there was nobody that supported this, really, between us and the president. Secretary Gates came on board, but of course he had just joined as the Secretary of Defense. The Joint Chiefs were either ambivalent or generally not favorable, just wanted to get us to hand off and come home, by and large. A bit of an overcharacterization, but generally so. There were other areas, legislation. We employed every tool in the arsenal, some of which I can't talk about, but which future organizations I was privileged to lead could play a role. I used something called preemptive praise with Prime Minister Maliki at times. This is where I would go in and say, Sayyid Rais al-Wazira, so good to see you. I'm so pleased that you are considering this particular action. I had no idea, and he starts to protest. I say, there's no need for you to say anything, Prime Minister. I know how difficult the decision that must have been for. I just can't tell you how delighted I am. I can barely sleep. I'm so enthusiastic about it. You just keep going on until he finally, okay, I guess I have to do this. So we would try that. I mean, I had an interpreter who had been with me for years, came back with me every single time, continued to work for me at CENTCOM. In fact, I was just with Sunni Arab leaders with him in Switzerland, where I was asked by the European Institute of Politics to help with Sunni Arab mediation between them, not just between them and Shia. And he would actually would cook this all up. He'd call Prime Minister Maliki at 10 or 11 at night. He carried my cell phone. I mean, I didn't want to, they'd call me on the darn thing, and they called him all night, all hours, for the most trivial things or the most important, and so he'd take care of them. But he'd call the Prime Minister and say, look, Prime Minister, I don't think you realize, but General Petraeus was really wounded today by what you said. He felt terrible. I could see his morale is devastated. He just left this evening, you know, he went back to he just closed the door. He's really, really concerned. And, you know, and the Prime Minister, oh, dear, no, seriously? And I say, yes, Prime Minister. He doesn't know I'm calling you, of course. He'd never allow me to convey this to you. He'd say, well, why don't you come over and we can talk about it? And they'd talk, you know, until 2 in the morning, and the Prime Minister would then come around. So you tried every which way that you possibly could. And we also had what were called full range of emotion meetings. I would tell my translator again, he was part of the team. And he and I and Ambassador Crocker would ride over together, and most times we had talking points. This is all formal. Bill Rapp's guys would collect all week all the talking points, because we had the one meeting together with the Prime Minister every single week for at least an hour. Then we also attended their National Security Council meeting, and there were some other interfaces that we would have. But that meeting was crucial. And so we'd go in there, and I would tell my interpreter ahead of time, this is going to be, as I said, this, you know, and I, what I want you to do is let me show the full range of emotions right up until the point that you think I'm no longer acting. And if that happens, that's when you pluck at my sleeve and I get the, oh, you know, and I come back to my senses, because you can get so angry. This is serious, serious stuff. It's not trivial, and you can get pretty worked up about it. And what I wanted to do was avoid doing something that was so-called non-biodegradable. And that's where you say something that never goes away, or do something that's never forgiven. And so that's, you have to get right up to that line. They're emotional with us, and I occasionally, it was not nature, but occasionally I would do the same thing with them.
Okay, next, please. Thank you very much.
Yep.
For the panel, I'd like to start with John and then move to Richard, then move to Bo. John, you can start.
Yeah, I'd like first to give a shout-out to my former colleagues from the Strategic Studies Institute who sat with me earlier this week to prepare me for this thing. Particularly, they're really great scholars, a couple of them, Don Snyder and Steve Metz. So,
Don here?
Yeah, Don's here. Yeah.
And in that discussion, I would say that there are two or three subjects that were really of concern to them and to me. One was the strategic legacy of the surge.
Yep.
You know, the strategic value of it. And the other was interrelated, the replicability and the sustainability.
Sure.
Now, since we're not going to have a 3 or 4 hour discussion, I think I'll pick the replicability and sustainability question to ask you. Although you can certainly talk about the legacy if you want. If the coin doctrine that you and Con Crane produced was responsible for the strategic, operational, and tactical success in Iraq, of the surge in Iraq, the tenets of that doctrine ought to be applicable to other situations around the world, although I would not contend that you could do that in a cookie-cutter way. As the coalition commander in Afghanistan just a couple of years after the surge in Iraq, you, General Petraeus, saw the challenges of trying to replicate the success of the Iraq surge in a different theater. Some critics, and I'll say I'm not one of them, but some critics will say you were too focused on an exact replication. The cookie-cutter approach that I said wouldn't work. How can the tenets of the COIN doctrine be applied elsewhere? Are they replicable?
Sure.
And in your response,
yep,
please touch on your experience in Afghanistan,
sure,
but also talk about how the doctrine might have worked in Libya a few years ago,
sure,
how it might be applied in Syria today, and perhaps most importantly, and I'm an old Korea hand like Con Crane a bit, how it might be applied in North Korea in an unpredictable future. I contend that the doctrine can be applied, but the strategic success in counterinsurgency requires large numbers of troops on the ground and American strategic patience.
Not necessarily, and I think that's what I sought to highlight earlier. Look, the bottom line up front is they can be applied if it is indeed a counterinsurgency campaign situation, but they have to be applied very, very thoughtfully and with recognition that every situation is unique. The fact is that Afghanistan was not Iraq. I actually did an assessment in Afghanistan. You know, Rumsfeld was wonderful because, you know, he'd give you a reward by asking you to do something else. I remember I went over, I'd gotten home as a two-star. I'd been home for a couple months. I was finally attending one of the general officer training courses that you're supposed to go to. And I'd just gotten through the icebreaker, i.e. the night before it actually starts. And I got a call that said, you got to go over to Iraq right away and do an assessment of why the Iraqi security forces did so miserably in March of 2004. And yet the ones up in Mosul had done actually pretty well. So anyway, I left that course, never finished it, and got on a plane with the team, went over there, did an assessment for a couple weeks, came home and laid out stuff for Secretary Rumsfeld had a bunch of recommendations. He said, super, this is really good. Now go back, change out a division command, and get over there and implement them. So that was how I ended up going back to Iraq within a few months of coming home for another 15 and a half months. And on the way home from that one, he came out and saw me a week or so before the end of that tour, and we were making progress. And he's seeing it. There's some real organizational architecture ideas. It's working along. I mean, again, it's always imperfect. There's always steps backwards as well as steps forward. But I remember he said, "No, I'd like to have just a word with you myself if I could." And we were in one of these armored SUVs. All the security guys get out. And literally, he's patting me on the back. And I think, this is okay. And I turn it so he can really apply it. And he says, "You've done such a wonderful job here. This is really great. And so what I'd like you to do is come home through Afghanistan." I said, "Mr. Secretary, you know, I've been home once in the last 15 and a half months. I think it was to see our son graduate or something. And now you want me to go to Afghanistan?" He said, "Yeah, just take a look over there." So anyway, we take a team. We go over there, came back. Frankly, there was a huge number of recommendations. But the very first slide in that briefing was titled, "Afghanistan Does Not Equal Iraq." And we laid out all the different areas of comparison and showed that enormous challenges that Afghanistan posed, and lack of education, illiteracy, lack of economy, lack of knowledge of governance, lack of infrastructure, and above all, sanctuaries for the enemy that were just insurmountable. So you could not get to the leadership of the Taliban in Baluchistan down to the south. You could not get to the leadership of the Haqqani network all that often, every now and then, in North Waziristan. And we were able to disrupt the Al-Qaeda senior leadership, but since we couldn't take over the terrain, we had that age-old problem. All you can do is disrupt them, so you got to keep disrupting them. By the way, we still do, and I'm okay with that, if you can do that in a sustainable manner. So when I had the confirmation hearing, unexpectedly to be the commander in Afghanistan after serving for about 19 months as commander of Central Command, I told the Congress, we will not be able to achieve, we will not be able to flip Afghanistan the way we were able to flip Iraq. And I'll say, and I said, you may remember me saying that I did believe we could do in Iraq what we ultimately did, much to your skepticism, I know, but it actually was done. It will not be done in Afghanistan. What we need to do is halt the momentum of the Taliban. We need to reverse it in some key areas. We need to accelerate the development of the Afghan security forces and certain Afghan institutions. We do want to reduce the violence year on year to the extent that we can, but make no mistake about it, if you can't go after the leaders, the sanctuaries, the bases, I wish I had the Afghan Anaconda slide, because I can show you how limited we were in being able to do some of the tasks that needed to be done to squeeze the life out of them. If you can't do that, then you are not going to be able to flip it. You can't promote reconciliation if you can't get the leaders removed from the equation, or feeling threatened, or indeed a lot of them feeling that their choice is to reconcile or perhaps die. And so, frankly, that was proven out. Now, we did halt the momentum. We did reverse it in some cases. We did accelerate the development of the Afghan security forces, basically achieved what we set out to do, but we did not achieve the dramatic flipping, the dramatic driving down of violence that we achieved in Iraq. And so, again, I just think, and I was very conscious of the differences between the two. It's why I raised the slide. There's no question but that Iraq is in the back of your mind if you've experienced that, but also was the awareness about how unique Afghanistan was, and the same is true of anywhere. I think we are arguably beginning to execute something along these lines in Syria. I can actually sketch that out for you, how we can, you know, what you have to do is you've got to, in addition to going after Al-Qaeda and the Al-Qaeda affiliate in the Islamic State, you have to then, your next objective no longer becomes a democratically elected, pluralist, multi-ethnic, multi-sectarian government in Syria, in Damascus, which is clearly unattainable. You just have to basically try to end the violence. And you do that by safe havens and interim solution, And I think, by the way, that is ultimately what is going to happen there, and it's a shame we didn't start doing that. Well, there's a shame we didn't do a lot of things in Syria when we had the opportunity, frankly. I don't want to try to apply it to every other place. You can't apply it everywhere. I don't know that Libya is necessarily a model for it. I could probably construct some kind of strategy like this if you want to go through it. But again, it's such a unique situation with 3 to 4 major different groups that you would have to work out that I'm not actually sure that some of the models that we have would actually apply. What I would say is that what we are doing now is actually sustainable, even in Afghanistan. Yes, the situation has gotten worse. It's deteriorated over the last year or perhaps longer. There's been forthright acknowledgement of that. Yes, we shouldn't have reduced it as quickly as we did. It's publicly known that I recommended not reducing the surge as quickly as was done, although obviously I ultimately supported the president's decision. But by the way, if you ever want to feel the oxygen go out of the Situation Room, when the decision is announced, and you know they go around the room and say, "Oh, yeah, Hillary, you okay? Bob, you're okay? Okay, okay. Oh, Dave, are you okay?" Say, "Mr. President, as I reminded you on day one, the first meeting that we had a week ago, my advice to you is based on the facts on the ground, informed by an awareness of all the stuff with which you have to uniquely deal, but driven by the facts on the ground, and with great respect, there's been no change in the facts on the ground in the last week, so my recommendation is unchanged." And it's quite a magic moment to do that and survive. Now, let me just show you one other, if I can show a slide that does show security incidents, which is slide 6. If you can go to that quickly. It is worth, you know, what was the strategic effect, the value of the surge and so forth? You know, if because it wasn't sustained for 10 years, should it have been tried? I think, of course, it should have been tried. I mean, the fact is that we were able, with our Iraqi security force partners and coalition partners, to dramatically drive violence down, enormously. By the way, this is where that bomb, see, the strategy was going along okay. And that's why I wanted to caveat this and mention that, and it wasn't really until in here somewhere that the light came on for a lot of us and we realized this is not working. And it was unhinged by this terrible event right here, the Samar mosque bombing, this sacred shrine that was blown up, and then the cycle of sectarian violence that was set off by that, Sunni on Shia, militias making the most out of it, Sunni Arabs doing the same, back and forth. And then the surge starts to be implemented just a week before this. By the way, I'll point out as well, these two downturns right here, this was Operation Together Forward number 1. This is Operation Together Forward number 2. These were operations conducted in very volatile neighborhoods in Iraq. And these events were following the clear and hand off rather than the clear and hold. But if you really experience, live this, I can almost explain every little dip in this stuff. And then it actually goes up. And I told Congress it's going to get much worse before it gets better because we're going back into the neighborhoods. We're going to have to take these places away from those who are trying to fight over them. They're going to fight us back. But then the violence is going to come down. And thank goodness that before the 11 September 2007 testimony right in here, and that was obviously a picture from either that or the one 6 months after that, the level of violence came down so dramatically because of what we were doing to the Sunni Arabs and then also because the Shia militia took a knee after we hung around their neck the killing of 3 governors of southern provinces, Shia provinces, and 3 police chiefs of Shia provinces, and they were a Shia militia, and they disrupted the holy Shia celebration at the holy city of Karbala, which prompted the prime minister himself with 100 vehicles to go with a pistol on his hip to confront them, and that was very important. And then it continues to go down. We know that ultimately we're going to have to confront the Shia militia. That's right in here, the Battle of Sadr City and Basra, and then it really comes down. And by the way, if you pull this out all the way to 2011, it continues to come down. And I think the strategic legacy is that we gave the Iraqis an extraordinary opportunity to transform their country. Tragically, Prime Minister Maliki undid that at the end of 2011 after we left. I'm not one who believes that if we'd left 10,000 troops, it would have guaranteed that we would not have seen him do what he did. But the fact is that we would have been able to resume helping the Iraqi security forces much more rapidly. And that is critical because, as everybody knows, the sooner you can show that a group like the Islamic State is a loser instead of a winner, is the sooner they're no longer effective in their most cherished point, which is cyberspace. Keep in mind that that's how they were communicating, proselytizing, inspiring, recruiting, and everything else, and command and controlling. So critical there as well. So thanks, Jer. And thanks again for all that you did there when we were soldiering side by side.
Sure, thanks. Just to set this question up real quick, I was going to draw you out a little bit more on the interagency elements of what you talked about, and maybe to suggest, as part of your answer, a professional military education kicker at the end. I think I have to do that to maintain my standing. So what I wanted to touch on a little bit is you laid out the point about stability operations, and I appreciate your emphasis on that. I know I feel very strongly, too, about that as being an important component of what the military has to be able to do. But when I know in OSD policy, where I was working at the same time working on the counterinsurgency manual, we also emphasized that a lot of the, and I'm just to quote one sentence from the stability ops directive we had at the time, said many stability operations tasks are best performed by indigenous, foreign, or U.S. civilian professionals. And so I kind of wanted to push you a little bit on the importance of the civilian surge, and not just sort of how it played out then, but your sense of the prospects for improvements on the civilian side of the interagency dynamic going forward, that is their role in stability operations, and maybe any recommendations you have on ways that that might be improved.
Yep.
And then also the implications for the military, particularly the Army, and that's where the PME, are there things we can do education-wise to improve how we think about that?
Well, one of the big ideas was that we had to intensify what was already a civil-military campaign. I mean, we had pretty ideal circumstances in Iraq compared with, say, a number of other coalition campaigns, including really the one in Afghanistan, in that we had a single chain of command. I reported to the CENTCOM commander, the ambassador reported directly to the State Department. So it was all U.S. You didn't have the complication of a NATO chain of command as I did in Afghanistan, which then makes your relationship with the U.S. ambassador more sensitive. So you just can't do everything in Afghanistan with just the U.S. ambassador. You have a NATO senior civilian representative, in fact. And you have a number of other ambassadors, and those NATO forces counted for 50,000 out of 150,000, whereas in Iraq, the vast majority of forces was U.S., with, again, some British and other coalition forces in southern provinces, which were more the Shia Arab areas. So you had an opportunity where you could really bring it all together, and we did. In fact, by the way, H.R. McMaster did a wonderful civil-military strategic review partnered with an ambassador who was a colonel at the time. He did three of those during my time as the commander of the surge. Midway through, of course, it's well known that I went back to sit on a promotion board. Only time I've ever done that, and the irony of doing that when you're commanding the surge. But there was an important task at hand, which included ensuring that he would become a flag officer. Never mentioned to me, never a specified task, but clearly in the back of my mind was what the military would call an implied task, and I'm obviously very, very pleased that I did that for today. So look, we did a campaign plan that was explicitly civil and military, signed by both the ambassador and myself. And didn't have the latitude to do that in Afghanistan. It had to be a coalition document, and then we had a separate U.S. one that we could partner with the State Department. I used to get flack over the, quote, military or the civilian crap in my mission statement and campaign plan. And I said, well, with great respect, this is a civil-military campaign. Now, the State Department and other agencies did surge. Known that when I went to see President Bush before deploying, He said, okay, General, you know, you're now confirmed and so forth. And so I was waiting for some guidance and basically just get over there and, you know, turn it around. And the truth is we didn't need guidance. We knew what needed to be done. We'd been doing it, and then we'd had this enormous intellectual exercise to bring it all together. General Odierno had been back during that time, a lot of us, and then went back and then sought to put into action what we knew and believed needed to be done. But we did need civilian partners. And so having the Department of State, having the Department of Homeland Security, having the Department of Justice, all of these others, Treasury, forensic, we did a counterterrorism financing task force. Again, every element there, you had to have something that was pointed at taking it away from the insurgents. The challenge was that they never had the resources they needed. I went back, it's well known, a number of occasions. I was, you know, sort of the poster child for military guy asking for more spending for the Department of State. A number of secretaries asked me to do that. Admiral Mullen was another one. It's also why, more recently, it's well known that I was one of the signatories of a letter that supported spending on the Department of State at a time when obviously that's being considered. And I even at one point, as a three-star, while back at Leavenworth doing the counterinsurgency field manual, laid out, you saw the engine of change that we used to use to illustrate what we were trying to do with the elements of the combined modern center, really the Army writ large, actually proposed an interagency engine of change, and it had all the elements. And as you know, Richard, there was a national security planning directive on this. So I even found documents that had been done, not just the military, not just the Army and Marine Corps field manual or the Department of Defense document, but an actual NSPD that was on all of this. So you actually had the foundational documents. And then I even put together how you'd train together and study together and do a few other things together. Now, the truth is that's valuable not just for a counterinsurgency campaign. It's valuable for any campaign because you are always, in today's day and age, going to have stability operations. The fact is that I have, for some time, questioned privately as well as publicly, so in other words, inside the institution as well, that if you look at the mission statement of some of our commanders downrange today, I don't think they are sufficiently inclusive. I think it should not only say, let's say, you know, enable Iraqi security forces to defeat the Islamic State and the Al-Qaeda affiliate, and it then should say, and support the development of inclusive governance that will promote, that will avoid, you know, fertile grounds for the planting of the seeds of extremism and the rise of ISIS 3.0. Because everybody knows it's the battle after the battle of Mosul that matters. It's the battle of Nainoa province governance. It's the battle of Baghdad governance. And that's, again, what really matters. And the people who are going to be in the front lines of that fight will not necessarily be wearing uniforms. They will be diplomats. They'll be development workers. They will be intelligence officers. They'll be Department of Justice, Treasury, all these others who are helping, in this case, Prime Minister Abadi, who knows the Iraqi Prime Minister, who knows that there has to be inclusive governance, without which, again, the Sunni Arabs are not going to do what they did during the surge, which was to rejoin the fabric of Iraqi society, to bring that back together, which was one of the historic achievements of the surge. And again, you know, to come back to JR's question, the strategic implications of this, well, they had, you know, four or so years of being, having a fairly unified fabric of society until it was undone by these actions, the highly sectarian actions of Prime Minister Maliki to shore up his Shia political base in advance of the parliamentary elections that he was facing, I think, in 2012. So we need to develop this further. If anything, it has probably atrophied a bit or been reduced a bit in terms of capabilities. And again, the idea that you're going to have a sterile battlefield, I think, is obviously couldn't be further from reality.
Thanks, sir. Sir, legitimacy is one of the terms central to our counterinsurgency doctrine. And you mentioned a little bit earlier how Prime Minister Maliki wasn't supportive in the long run of our rule of law efforts. Looking back, in a world of strongman governments, or at least in an area of strongman governments, is perceived legitimacy of the host nation, a term often cited in the insurgency manual, counterinsurgency manual, is legitimacy as important as the perceived strength of government through the eyes of the host nation?
Legitimacy is hugely important, Bo, thanks. And thanks again for what you did during the surge as a battalion commander. Very, very tough place at a time when we were taking very tough losses and a lot of individuals wounded. But we should be careful not to equate legitimacy with government that is elected the way we believe government should be elected. At some point in time there, it may have been as early as, again, very early 2003, in my own mind, the big idea for me on governance was that governance needed to be representative of all the people of an area. So all of the, you know, so it had to be Sunni and Shia, Arab and Kurd, Turkmen, Yazidi, this is in Nainoa province, Mosul, Christian, Shabak, Turkmen, and so on. It had to be responsive to them within the means that were available. And above all, it had to guarantee minority rights as well as facilitate majority rule. Frankly, if you test governments with that, that's not bad. You know, Sultan Qaboos in Oman, been in power for, 45, 50 years, I think has enormous legitimacy. There's never been an election in the country that I'm aware of, or if there is a parliament, there are bodies, there are representative groups and so on. But the real key is that people feel that their voices are heard. They feel that there is a response to them. He has made a number of changes over the years, and it gradually is doing that in a very skillful way. And yet ensures minority rights as well as majority rule. And I think if you test governments in that region or in any region against that, that's not bad, and they'll have legitimacy. I mean, the government of the United Arab Emirates, seen as highly legitimate by the people. The governments in a number of other places. The challenge is that, philosophically speaking, you know, and Don and some of the other social sciences department alumni who are here will then note that generally a government that is elected democratically by nature, the people have a voice, by nature they have representation, and you know, if all else fails they can throw the bums out. That's not available if you have strongman rule. And of course the limitations of strongman rule were, you know, in tremendous evidence during the Arab Spring when one longtime autocrat after another, Tunisia, Egypt, Libya, Syria, even Yemen, were opposed by the people because there was no outlet for their grievances. They were feeling highly dissatisfied. So the question is, how can you achieve governance that, again, meets those standards, if you will, without necessarily having to have all the other elements? And the truth is that the Iraqis did have a legitimate election in 2008 and also in 2012. I may have the dates off, but you know, the election of, we may not have welcomed the re-election of Nouri al-Maliki, but the election was legitimate. He lost by one parliamentary vote to another coalition who could not form a government. And so at the end of the day, then Maliki could, so he ends up, you know, you may not welcome that, you may not applaud that, you may wish that, again, Dr. Alawi could have prevailed, but at the end of the day, there was legitimacy to that. And in fact, the subsequent election actually results in him being ousted because the Shia Arabs realize he's led them down the path of ruin and there's going to have to be more inclusiveness or the reality is going to be endless insurgency. So these are tough issues, and these, at the end of the day, get back to the heart of so-called political philosophy, you know, as it, and comparative politics and all this stuff, some of which wasn't taught for a while on campuses because, you know, we had the supposed end of history. You know, the wall came down, the communists all collapsed, we won, history's over, the dialectic of Hegel or whatever it is complete, only to find out that, you know, it's being taught again now. And now the comparative politics is a system in China that, for all of its shortcomings and lack of freedoms and other deficiencies, did manage to produce for its people something no other country has ever produced, and that's two decades of double-digit GDP growth, except for maybe 1 year in there, which ain't bad. And anybody who's ever ridden on the bullet trains over there, been in downtown Beijing, been to some of the other developed cities, pretty extraordinary what they've accomplished in the past 30 or 40 years. Again, we may not like the deficiencies in our eyes, but I don't think there's a question about the legitimacy of that government. So again, all I'm really doing is at some length explaining that while we firmly believe that our system is, as Churchill used to say, the worst form of government except for all the others, it's preferable, but there are some other alternative systems for other places. So we shouldn't always immediately say it's got to look like, smell like, and sound like what we have. The question is, how do you achieve legitimacy? And at the end of the day, if you apply those tests I had earlier, I think that's a benchmark for it, at least. Noting that, unfortunately, over time, benevolent autocrats sometimes turn into less benevolent ones, as we saw, say, with President Mubarak, who had 10 good years, 10 middling years, and then 10 lousy years, at the end of which you have Tahrir Square. On the other, you know, and so the response to what I've just said often is, well, there are very few Lee Kuan Yews in the world. You know, the great Singaporean leader who was fairly autocratic in the early days. His party still happens to be in power. In fact, I'm sure it's purely coincidental. His son is the prime minister. But, you know, people are pretty happy in Singapore, actually, by and large. So, and certainly, again, the development's been pretty extraordinary.
John?
I'm an old force structure guy, so I'm going to ask a force structure question. Now that we're post-Iraq, generally, and pretty clearly on the downslide in Afghanistan, you know there's forces in the Army and more broadly across the Department of Defense that are pushing the military back from a focus on counterinsurgency to a focus on major combat operations. If you believe, as I do, that insurgents are the more likely foe of the U.S. military over the next few decades, let's say, how would you build today's Army? And my focus clearly on the Army, but sure. Broadly the military.
Yep. Well, look, first of all, you know, I'd love to see as many special operations forces as you can ever possibly build, but, you know, they're special. They're specially selected. They're specially trained. They're specially equipped. They are often given special, and with respect, one issue I would take with what you said up front was that the SF, the special forces, so not just the special mission units, but the actual Green Beret special forces, whose lot in life has typically been irregular warfare, were doing more direct action. That's fairly unique to Iraq. In Afghanistan, for example, the Green Berets, as well as white SOF, if you will, so the normal SEAL teams, not SEAL Team 6, and the new Marine Special Operations Forces were all doing the Afghan the village stability operations, which led to the Afghan local police program. In fact, we had you never had enough of them. And actually, my point would be about SOF, build as many as you can, but keep them special. And that means, by definition, you're never going to have all those that you'd want remotely. And so, in fact, in Afghanistan, I actually took two general-purpose infantry battalions, and split them up over the special operations forces, one in the north, one in the south, to thicken them. So we'd take a special forces team, we'd split it in half, we'd give it, so that means it's probably down to six or seven each, and then we'd give them at least a squad plus of infantry to thicken them, and that enabled us to do twice as many Afghan local police programs, something that was desperately needed. Started too late and curtailed too soon, unfortunately. Look, I applaud what the Chief of Staff is doing with these advise and assist brigade combat teams. You know, we'll have to see how it works. What we're doing right now, though, is we are taking a general brigade combat team and we're leaving behind half of it or more, splitting it up, and we're making a tailor-made advise and assist brigade combat team. So maybe we ought to build some from the ground. So that adds yet another type of brigade combat team to the type we already have of sort of the light infantry air assault, mountain and airborne. Then you have the striker, and then you have obviously the heavy brigade combat teams. Again, remembering that first slide that I put up on full spectrum operations, you're going to need all kinds of different forces, and the challenge is always going to be for the commanders at a certain level to integrate all that they can get, and that's what we have to ensure that we still inculcate. So while I'm supportive of decisive force operations at the combat training centers, because we do need some of that kind of skill without question, you also have to do that, still have to do what could be a regular warfare. You may have to do advise and assist. And you're never going to have enough special forces to do all of the advising and assisting that you want to do. I remember at Fort Leavenworth, the commander out there had something like six different hats, and one of them was created by Rumsfeld when I went out there, yet another of his gifts. It was to form something called the joint, it was a joint force element, so it was all different services that looked at to try to capture the train and equip missions that we'd done in Iraq and in Afghanistan, the JCISFA, the Joint Center for International Security Force Assistance. And in that, we actually made a list of all the types of missions you could possibly have for advise and assist, and then all the possible elements that could do it. And very quickly, you run out of special forces, so then you're into what? Where else can you get these capabilities? And just as an intellectual exercise, it was instructive to us, again, that you're always going to have a total force that's going to have all of these different capabilities. And that's sort of unique to the United States, which is the only military in the world now that truly can be said to have true global capabilities. All of the others, even the Chinese, basically are still mostly concerned about security of their immediate region, even as they are, yes, developing the string of pearls, the bases that get them all the way out to the Middle East, but that's about as far as it goes, and they haven't shown a capability to operate there in any kind of enduring fashion. The key that we do have to come back to, I think, is the idea of sustainable strategies. And sustainability, again, is measured in two metrics, blood and treasure. And I think if it's sustainable in those terms, you can do it forever. And I have no qualms about, I think what we should do in Afghanistan now is make an enduring commitment, stop the year-on-year angst over how much we're going to draw it down that year or whatever. Yes, we got to get our Afghan security force partners to make some changes. Yes, the institutions have to try to drive some of the corruption out. Yes, it's a tough place. You know, it's really difficult to have the rule of law if your major export crop is illegal. But, you know, you have to work your way through that. At the end of the day with Afghanistan, what we cannot forget is that there's a reason that we went there, and there's a reason we have stayed. The reason we went there is because we did not ever want Afghanistan to once again be a sanctuary for transnational extremists like Al-Qaeda, the way it was when Al-Qaeda planned the 9/11 attacks there and conducted the initial training of the attackers there. And we have actually accomplished that mission so far. The challenge is that we need to keep at it, but if you can do that with, you know, 13, 14,000 troops, that's a third or a quarter of what we've had in Korea at various points in time, but you can do it in a way that is, again, is not costing vast sums of money and is not seen large loss of life or seriously wounded returning to Dover, then I think you probably have a sustainable strategy for a mission that I think does deserve to be continued. But that's the kind of reality. And, you know, the challenge of today is that you're going to see more of this, because wherever there are ungoverned spaces in the Middle East and Central Asia and elsewhere, you will see extremists. They will exploit them. The effects of those Las Vegas rules are not in do not apply in those areas. What happens there doesn't stay there. Sadly, it tends to spew violence, extremism, and a tsunami of refugees, not just into the neighborhood, but into our European allies, causing the biggest political challenges they have had in decades. Number three is the U.S. has to lead in responding to that. There's no substitute for that. The enablers that I described earlier, you can take all of our possible coalition partners and allies together and multiply it times 6 or 7, you still wouldn't have what we can bring to bear to enable a host nation force. And then it has to be a comprehensive campaign. There's no escaping the need for all of the different tasks here, but the beauty is you want your host nation partners to do it. You want coalition elements there. You especially want Muslim nations there, by the way, so that we don't want to antagonize them with various actions. And then the fifth is, this is a generational struggle. This is not the struggle of a decade, much less a few years. We're going to be at this for a very, very long time, and we need, therefore, to have a sustainable strategy.
Richard. Con, I was going to say, actually, sir, thanks very much for your comments and, Con, your presentation, but I'd be happy to cede my time to the audience for any follow-up questions.
Great. Yep. Any sure. last thing from
Sir, I'd agree with the dean.
Okay. That's right. Let's open to the...
Bring it on.
Let's go. Let's open up to the audience then.
Wait, ladies and gentlemen, if you raise your hands, we'll be around with the microphone. We'll start here in the center.
Okay.
Yeah. Oh, yeah.
Much of what was presented today has an undeniable tone of intellectualism.
Guilty.
What happens when your surge of ideas runs up against the public and the politicians' demand for simplistic solutions, such as we're just going to bomb them until the desert glows?
It's a wonderful question. In fact, I have pointed out on numerous occasions, as an example, that I am 100% behind carpet bombing if and only if the enemy will lay himself out as a carpet in an area where there are no civilians and there's no infrastructure. And in such situations, I am all for bringing the B-52s over, opening the bomb bays, and letting dumb bombs as well as precision munitions fall out. No, I think, you know, at the end of the day, you've got to have you have to have simple ways of explaining what it is we're trying to do as well. And you can do that, I think. I think the big ideas can be reduced pretty succinctly to some very important ones that I think can be grasped by audiences that haven't spent their career in uniform or at the Army War College or, you know, getting PhDs or these kinds of things. But you lay something out that's very important. And the truth is that seemingly attractive, obvious ideas, such as, you know, let's, again, bomb them back to the Stone Ages, let's make the rubble bounce and all this kind of stuff. And what you have to do is explain that, as attractive as that sounds, there are occasionally some circumstances where it's not quite as applicable, including those where we are going to fight 99% of the time. So I think that's the challenge that you do have. And, you know, you've got to lay those out. And the truth is, I think that those who put those forward, when they actually confront reality when they are in office, realize that, again, you have to have a slightly more nuanced approach to life than that.
Right there?
Yep. You might. And then there's, and then he can be next.
They got CCC Scott.
With your vast, broad knowledge and experience, I'd like to ask, what would be your feelings about the strategy we should use toward North Korea today?
This is the single biggest crisis out there, I think. I do make speeches all over the place. I'm still practicing the highest form of white-collar crime in America, which is the speaking circuit. by the way, I want you to know this is a waived speaking fee and everything else.
Yeah, that's right. Not from us. Not from us. That's right.
A terrible setback to your fundraising. What was the question again?
North Korea.
As I'm doing those pitches, you know, I get asked, you know, what is it? What are the challenges that confront us? And, you know, you list the revisionist states, if you will, revolutionary powers of Iran and Russia, and indeed North Korea, China. You list the Islamic extremist groups that are out there that are so challenging. There's now a new host of cyber threats, some of which in the hands of extremists could actually be potentially a weapon of mass destruction effect and so on. All of these, though, are generally ones that I don't think confront the new president of the United States in a way that North Korea could. He has said, he has established policy. He tweeted, ain't going to happen. Ain't going to happen when it came to, or not going to happen, when it came to North Korea having a nuclear device that could reach U.S. soil on an intercontinental ballistic missile. And if that is the case, and of course the reason that Secretary of State Tillerson was just in the region, ending with China, which is the key to this, needless to say, that's the country from which the umbilical cord runs to North Korea. It literally keeps the lights on in Pyongyang. It employs millions of North Koreans and provides hard currency. Yes, they've cut off coal imports to China from North Korea for the rest of the year, but they had huge imports in the several months leading up to that. So they, more than any other country, are the one that may be able to exert the leverage on the madman who is leading this country. And of course, it's you can't allow a madman, I don't think, if you are the President of the United States, to have a weapon that could reach our soil and again, kill a catastrophic number of Americans. And so I think that one, that prospect, could confront, in a way that, you know, even the Soviets, where there was at least the concept of mutual assured destruction, there was a sense there was a real somewhat rational individual at the helm, certainly true of China, the other country, the other, if you will, competitor that has nuclear weapons that could reach us. Can a president allow North Korea, can it allow Kim Jong-un to have a nuclear weapon in his control? If the answer is no, and if we're not able through diplomatic means, sanctions, and a variety of other actions to keep them from getting this, then the prospect is that you're going to have to take it out. And you know, I've been part of some war games over the years and various efforts to try to figure out what you would do. It goes very, very, very large, very, very quickly because you don't know precisely where everything is all the time. You're going to have to take out a large number of spots. You probably have to take the air defenses out before you do that. And by the way, as you well know, our Korean partners are going to say, South Korean partners are going to say, well, what about us? There's 20 or 30,000 artillery tubes, rockets and missiles pointed at the greater Seoul area. So how about taking all that out while you're at it? You're into something very, very big. And what we have to do, and I think the reason that Rex Tillerson said we will use force if necessary, he would not take that off the table explicitly, is to send the kind of message to China that it is time to get really serious about cutting off various of the support mechanisms that have kept North Korea going. The challenge for China is, of course, they also don't want the prospect of a reunified Korean Peninsula, and so they're going to try to meter this and see how can they keep him going without allowing him to go forward. This is a very, very potentially very dangerous situation. I think it is the single crisis that is looming out there. And of course, again, that's why Secretary Mattis went there early on to the region as well. And of course, as I mentioned, why Secretary Tillerson has been there now also. Yep, right there. And then we might come up over here.
Okay, a couple years ago, I looked up the EU versus US defense spending. And at that point, the factor was about 3.67 times more that the U.S. was spending per capita than the EU. And in spite of the fact that their GDP per capita is very similar to ours. So I was wondering what you thought about the pros and cons of having a more coalition approach to policing the world in view of our $20 trillion sure. deficit.
Yep, yep. Well, look, this is where our president obviously is onto something. And it's legitimate and it's valid. He's not the first president to do that. I heard President Obama railing at our European partners at the Lisbon summit in 2010 when I was the commander of the coalition in Afghanistan. I heard Secretary Gates do it in his final address at the North Atlantic Council where we thought it was going to be all sweetness and light and everybody, and he just hammered them over this. So again, this is not new. NATO burden sharing was an issue all the way back when I was a young major writing speeches for the Supreme Allied Commander, and I'm sure it will continue to be an issue. What is new, I do think, is the way that this president has gotten their attention. And you may not agree with everything that he is pursuing or the style in which he pursues it, but I was actually at an event back in mid-December prior to the big Munich Security Conference, which is massive now. I was there a month or so ago. They had a much smaller gathering of many of European were the serving leaders, so the National Security Advisor of Germany, among others. And I was really taken by them saying, you know, geez, maybe we really do need to spend more on defense. Now, it's not just President Trump, of course, although that is a big factor. It's also NATO's newest savior, Vladimir Putin. He's the greatest gift to NATO in a number of decades. He's given NATO a reason to live again, to be great again. And so that, you know, these factors come together. But look, we're never going to be satisfied with what our partners of any country provide, whether it's boots on the ground, spending on GDP. What is remarkable is that the leader now among European nations, I think, in terms of percent of GDP, is Greece. And of course, that's because their GDP went like that. Their military spending didn't go down quite as much. But look, we should clearly have partners who do more. There was a huge undertone of that, obviously, in the president's meeting with Chancellor Merkel, and it deservedly so. The question is, how can we pursue that? How can we get them to do that? There's been commitments made at the Warsaw Summit. Can they follow through now? And we certainly shouldn't insist as best we can. Look, you know, I commanded the largest coalition in history in terms of numbers of countries. And having done that and realizing how in time-intensive coalition management and maintenance are, I would still once again side with Winston Churchill, who said also that the only thing worse than fighting with allies is fighting without them. And we want as many as we can get. And we especially want Muslim countries these days. So how about right there? Yep. And then we'll come down front here. We might position one down, or you have one positioned. Yep.
Thank you. Question I have there, do we get enough information from the president as to what to do before we go into one of these countries? And the reason I bring that up is a few years ago, we had a lecture here, and they were talking about a guy named Robert W. Comer, and he had written a document, Civil Affairs and Military Government in the Mediterranean Theater. And then I get to page 9 and 10, and it turns out there's this letter from President Roosevelt telling them what to do about civil affairs, and one of the items in it was the American government will guarantee the salaries and allowances, death benefits, pensions of those French and other military, naval, and civilian officials who join with the American Expeditionary Force. There were seven other things in there. It's pretty well spelled out by the president what we want done. Mm-hmm. It seems like in Iraq, you know, at least to the public, is, oh, I guess we're going to go in there and find out if they have any weapons of mass destruction, and I guess that's it. That sounded like the only mission statement you got from the president. Is there something in this manual? The president's got to lay out, you know, what do you want us to do?
Sure. Yeah. No, I mean, look, the military is very fond of always saying, you know, there should be a clear objective, there should be a clear end state, there should be all of these, and there should be. Unfortunately, even if you think there are prior to taking action, once, you know, you roll the iron dice of, I think it was Bismarck who said that, you just never know what's going to turn up. Look, I will note that I have, when I'm asked about Iraq, the one question I'll never answer, actually it used to be two, I used to never answer a question about why Army couldn't beat Navy in football, but now that's no longer such a sensitive issue. The other is, you know, should we or should we not have done Iraq? And look, as a guy who wrote more letters of condolence to America's mothers and fathers than anybody else, that's a subject that I'll never address. I have, though, offered three lessons just in a general sense about Iraq. The first is, and it's really to your point, you really ought to understand a country before you invade it. We went in without the kind of knowledge that was necessary, without the expertise that we needed. I remember the 101st Airborne Division, which I was privileged to command, I was given at various points, quote, experts who were with me, and they'd show up, and I'd say, well, tell me about this next city we're about to take down, and, you know, is it Sunni or Shia? I mean, it's a fairly basic question. I asked it about Hilla. By the way, it's the capital of Babel province, as in the biblical Babylon, and we actually went to the site of the Hanging Gardens and all this stuff. So he said, oh, that's a Sunni Arab area. It wasn't. It was Shia. It's way below the demarcation line, again, as Bo knows in particular from where he was. So you really ought to understand that. Then later on, we end up going up to Mosul and Nineveh. We weren't supposed to go up there. We didn't even have maps for it. We literally spent the entire night before this big, huge air assault printing paper maps because we didn't have any for that area. When we got up there, I said, well, where are all these State Department experts and the folks that are sitting up in the Kurdish region? They all came down. None of them knew anything about Iraq proper. They'd all been up in the Kurdish area. We didn't worry about the Kurdish area. You really ought to understand a country. Second is, you should not pursue policies that will create more bad guys than they take off the streets by their conduct. That's the same thing with an operation. We had that sign on my operations center. It was a question, will this operation take more bad guys off the street than it creates by its conduct? If you fire the military and don't tell them what their future is, you know, they're literally out of work and they don't know how they're going to get a salary, don't expect them to love you the next day. Don't expect them to support the new Iraq. You've just created hundreds of thousands of individuals with military training, most of whom took their weapons home, with an incentive to oppose the new Iraq, not to support it. Then you double down by taking out the Ba'ath Party all the way down to level 4. Okay, yep, you got to do Saddam. We were proud to have killed Saddam's sons, Hussein Uday, and others down to a certain level. But when you add level 4, you add tens of thousands of bureaucrats, many of whom were Western trained. The professors were all Western educated. As I used to observe, I mean, these were our kind of people. They drank. I mean, this is what we want to run, you know. And instead of these, and so Mosul University had 110 or 120 of these. I'm trying to reestablish Mosul University, you know, a university of 30,000 students. 120-ish of the tenured professors were Ba'ath level 4s. They had to join the Ba'ath Party to go overseas, come back, and we throw all of them out ultimately. We had reconciliation up there for a while, thanks to Ambassador Bremer letting me do an exception to policy, but ultimately that crumbled as well, which is why that area then also spiraled downward. So again, that's another one. And then third, don't do it all with a pickup team. Don't create the Coalition Provisional Authority and then a special sort of contracting entity and a special engineering entity and all the rest of this from scratch. Establish an embassy. Use the Army Corps of Engineers. Use the Army Contracting or Defense Contracting Agency. We have all of these. Just build off existing institutions that have existing lines of authority, appropriations, lawyers, all the rest of the elements that you want to build something early on. And again, that's the way we should have done it. Now, ironically, you mentioned Bob Comer, because some in here, I'm sure, will know that he was instrumental in Vietnam, albeit a bit late, in establishing a CORDS program, it was called, which was sort of a counterinsurgency approach. The tragedy of Vietnam, beyond the fact that there, more than perhaps even Iraq or Afghanistan, showed that you don't get to pick your host nation leaders. And that was always a tremendous weakness there that I don't know that we ever could have overcome. But we also sort of had the wrong strategy at the wrong time. When it was sort of a counterinsurgency, we fought a big war. When we did actually whittle it down and then had some counterinsurgency, and then, of course, we cut off the support. And ultimately, they ironically get defeated by tanks and maneuver units after we pull our air power and other support for them. But Comer got this. For what it's worth, my father-in-law, Bill Knowlton, was his deputy. Comer was a civilian. He was given flag rank of 2 or 3 stars. My father-in-law was a brigadier general at the time and was his deputy for a year and then was also an assistant division commander. But Comer had some very, very good stuff, and he's written some very penetrating. There's a classic article called Bureaucracy Does Its Thing, and it basically explains why the bureaucracy couldn't pursue sort of the revolutionary intellectual thinking that was really needed at the time for that particular effort. So right there, please.
Ladies and gentlemen, this will be the last question for the afternoon.
Well, sir, this is related to your reading. I noticed that during the surge, you found time to do some reading. You know, you were particularly Matthew Ridgway. And I just wonder if you could talk about some of the books you did read and that really meant something to you in during the surge and how you applied that. And then even for the future of the Army in terms of how important you think it is for the officer corps to really spend some time reading.
Well, I mean, that's the value of the Army War College, among many other elements, even though Smurf Vision is no longer here. I actually did look into Ridgway while I was still at Leavenworth. I mean, the beauty of Leavenworth is you have the Combat Studies Institute. It's yet another national asset. And I knew I was actually going back. I mean, a lot of people, this whole mythology that Tom Ricks put out, that Petraeus was sent out to pasture out and, you know, in the banks of the slow Missouri and sit there and watch the water go by. I mean, the chief told me, take a knee, actually, you know, get all rested up and everything else, help. The guidance he gave me, in fact, was shake up the Army, Dave. I said, I can do that, chief. And of course, the Counterinsurgency Manual is just one of those. We also overhauled all leader development for commissioned, non-commissioned warrant officers throughout the Army. The Command and General Staff College, the National Training Center rotations. A lot of work was already ongoing there, to be fair, to General Wallace and some others. But we've accelerated that. And then the lessons learned teams were coming back, and we were incorporating that in all the so-called DOTLMs, the Doctrine, Organizational Structures, Training, Material, Leader Development, even facilities and personnel. The CSI, I asked them to do studies of generals who had turned wars around. And Ridgway, obviously, was one who I think legitimately did that in Korea, where he took over a pretty rocky, shaky situation, stabilized it, got back up, reestablished the DMZ, and I think managed to retrieve what was, a fairly difficult circumstance. And for what it's worth, there's an author, a historian out in Stanford, who's written a book called Savior Generals. Ridgway was in that. I was also privileged to be in that. The book I read during the actual conduct of the surge that made the biggest impact on me was Grant Takes Command by Bruce Catton. Again, CSI director out there gave that to me. I thought, hey, thanks a lot. I mean, the last thing I need is a bunch of books to read. I'm going off to this really tough situation here. But, you know, it goes in my rucksack. It ends up in a table that I had next to my bunk. And I started leafing through it. I found it enormously relevant. And I think, again, that's what any military professional does, is find some similarities, some situations from which you can draw inspiration, strength, maybe some insight. And, you know, there were endless of these. By the way, I would challenge anybody in the room, because this is a room that loves this kind of challenge, to tell me any other general in America who ever was brilliant tactically. This is the battles in the land between the lakes. That's where he was tactical. So that would be division commander and below, basically, multiple brigades. Operational, where he was truly brilliant, of course, at Vicksburg, one of the greatest of all battles, where his own most trusted lieutenant writes a letter to him and has it put in the file that this is too risky. I mean, it's extraordinary. I mean, this is the guy who said, you know, Grant stood by me while I was crazy, and I stood by him while he was drunk. They had that close a relationship. And then strategically, I mean, people forget we could have lost the Civil War had it not been for the campaign that Grant, for the first time, pulls it all together for the entire Union force. The first one really given, or takes that authority and is given it. And he decides, okay, we're going to have, let me depict it for you all here. So this is going to be Sherman. He's going to come out, because remember, he saved the day at Chattanooga as well. And so you'll take Atlanta, then Savannah, and come north. You have a couple of different generals over time that came out of the Tidewater area. You had Sheridan ultimately go down the valley, take that away from the south for the first time, pick it clean, as they said. And then he is in Meade's back pocket, and his instructions to Meade are, you go where Lee goes and stay at him. And he realizes this is going to be hard after the first fight in the Wilderness campaign. He writes to the president, and he says, I intend to fight it out all summer on this line if that's what it takes. And it took all summer, all fall, all winter, all spring until April 1865. But that strategy yielded the victories that won the election for President Lincoln, because he would, if we'd had polls back then, he was behind McClellan, and McClellan would have sued for peace had it not been first for Atlanta, and then really the Sheridan's victory in the valley sealed that election for him. But again, throughout this book, you find all kinds of really inspirational moments. And one that I know JR and maybe some others in here heard me actually share with our headquarters and commanders on a really, really tough day was the story of Grant at Shiloh, his worst battle, really. The first day, they're almost driven back into the Tennessee River. He's just sitting on the riverbank that night. It's raining slowly. He's got a slouch hat on. He's under a tree. No available cover because it's all being used as makeshift hospitals. He can hear the screams of soldiers who are having limbs amputated. He hears the cries on the battlefield of those who haven't been recovered. And out of the dark, here comes his most trusted Lieutenant Sherman. Sherman pauses a moment, and he sees Grant sitting there with a stub of a cigar in his mouth. And then he says, well, Grant, we had the devil's own day today, didn't we? And Grant says, yep, lick him tomorrow, though. And that kind of determination, that kind of indomitable spirit was what we had to call on in the great units that I was privileged to lead during the surge, and where so many in this room played a role in a variety of different ways. But so let me end with that, actually, and just note how important I think, you know, study, reflection, intellectual preparation is. There are people that said, you know, Petraeus got lucky. I did get lucky, timing and so forth. But I would also contend, as the Roman philosopher used to observe, that luck is what happens when preparation meets opportunity. And I tried my whole life to prepare for that moment and to be ready ready for it, to have, you know, the field marshal's baton in your rucksack, as Napoleon said every soldier had in the ranks. By the way, I actually tied a little swagger stick to it. I went to a British clothing sales store outside Aldershot one time when I was a lieutenant. Said, got any field marshal's batons? I'd sort of like to put one in my rucksack. I wasn't joking. And I was with this British airborne lieutenant. And I said, oh, fresh out, mate, but we have this little swagger stick. And so I actually took a swagger stick and I strapped it to the side of my rucksack. I didn't tell anybody about it. It was always there. And every time I looked at that, I realized, you know, 10 more push-ups, or, you know, run a little faster or read a little bit more. Because it is about preparation. And that is what this War College and other institutions like do so uniquely for the military. There's no other branch of government. There's no other department that takes the time to do leader development. And hopefully the kind of reflection that we've had here today is that kind of enriched, I think, discussion that you can have at a place like this, which is so important. I want to end by just thanking each and every one of you in here for being part of a community that has been amazingly supportive of our men and women in uniform and of their families. There was a moment, one of the memorable moments, the positive memorable moments in Baghdad, second year of the surge, 4th of July, 2008, where I was the presiding officer for the largest reenlistment in our military's history. 1,215 soldiers, sailors, airmen, and Marines. It was really extraordinary, and ironically, in one of Saddam's old palaces, in one of these big old domes. And as I was reciting the oath, and they would repeat after me, I looked out at them and, you know, wondered, what is this all about? I mean, how many? They're in combat, and by taking this oath, they're coming back to combat. We know that. There was no expectation at that point in time that this was all going to draw down and go away. You know, they weren't doing it for the stock options. So, you know, what is this? And I realized this is about individuals who feel very privileged to perform a mission that is larger than self for their country, who believe it's special to do that with others who feel the same way. And then, you know, at the end of the day, they realize that folks back home support them and their families. You've been among those, and I will always be grateful to you for that. Thanks very much.